And it hit me this morning. I have never been more shaken, isn't the word. More gripped by the understanding and the sorrow and the grief that my fellow countrymen, my fellow humans, have willfully turned themselves over spiritually, culturally, metaphysically, to the apparatus of tyranny, the common sense to stand against it. The shreds of honor is all we need to stop this. But the lapdog nature, the cowardly nature of the corporate henchmen that pose as reporters, that pose as journalists, is going to deliver us into a nightmare scenario. And we're already in a nightmare scenario, but it is going to absolutely spiral out of control now. And you can even see the rotting evil globalists that are running it falling apart in front of our very eyes as they stoke the flames of the funeral pyre that is meant to disintegrate humanity. These people are committed to evil. And then I look at the news and I look at what's happening and I juxtapose it to Donald Trump going to Mexico and saying, let's fight globalism and the New World Order together that have been looting our nations. Let's work together. It isn't that Donald Trump listens to what I have to say. It isn't that Donald Trump's synced with Alex Jones. He is synced to the spirit of resistance. We're tuned into the same historical understanding. I said on air yesterday, no one knows what he's going to say in Mexico. I said, I would say let's battle globalism together. And that's what he did. Unbelievable. And you could just see God giving us this last chance with Donald Trump. Undoubtedly, Donald Trump has been heaven sent. And that's why the system is frothing in fear. So for all the bad things that are happening, a lot of good is happening as well. And all I can tell you is our worst analysis of the globalist plan wasn't as bad as it actually is. And I'm telling the media and everybody else that sold out to this system, you people are out of your minds. Where is your discernment, your gut? I mean, you think you're going to ally with this and you're going to be winners? Oh my God. This is the greatest evil the planet has ever faced. We'll be back. Stay with us. That's some interesting science fiction from 2,000 years ago. Or is it? Well, we're living it one way or the other. It's either real in prophecy, or they've used it as a blueprint. And that's really the deception of the elite. They believe they're using it as a blueprint, which is the biggest joke of all. Because even if you're using it as a blueprint, you then make it reality, because that's what humans do. We build it. We make it. We're able to construct it if we can envision it. And that's why the globalists tell us that we're a bad species and an ugly species and a stupid species and need to be brushed off the earth, talking to us like they're not human because they're psychopaths. And a lot of psychiatrists and experts that study real psychopaths will tell you they're not people and they don't see you as having any value. They don't have the real human components like passion and love and honor. All they want to do is control. and hurt people. Look at drudgereport.com today if you're watching us on television. If you're on the radio, obviously go to Infowars.com or drudgereport.com and you can see these articles. Matt Lauer, Clinton Global member to moderate first presidential forum. That's right. He's a big part of their global initiative where people put money in there and then they launder it and take it right back out. She keeps 96% one year, 97% another year of the money for herself. At least she's better than Bono. Bono gives 1.2%. No, Hillary gives 3 or 4%. She's very gracious. Oh, boy. And now he's going to moderate the debate. You know, they don't want to make Trump a martyr, but Trump had better watch the food he's eating. And obviously Trump knows that. But it just hit me. They like to see a great man crawl. They want to bring down strong people and make them weak like they are. Poison's always the number one go-to, isn't it? But there are more high-tech forms of poison today. Electromagnetic. Just a thought. Continuing. Oh, Facebook satellite burns on the pad. But Facebook is a deep state organ, so I'm sure it'll get a few more of those up real quick. SpaceX rocket explodes at Cape Canaveral Space Center, blowing up Facebook's 150 million pound internet satellite. Let's stop right there. You know what's getting blown up right now? I'm going to make this announcement. Unequivocally, I'm sure of it. It hit me like a speed bullet freight train going downhill this morning. Hit me so hard that I was stunned for an hour or two. Ran over me like a thunderbolt. The main assault's on. Everything else has been a test. Everything else has been a beta test. Everything you've seen with the globalists studying cultures, societies, economies, getting everything rigged from the stock market to interest rates to currency rates, admittedly all rigged now. They now have major newspapers have computers writing news stories for them. I told people about that 10 years ago. The CIA developed it. Now it's ubiquitous. The ships are going to robot. The cars are going to robot. The trucks are going to robot. The technocracy is in place. The New World Order is now officially, in 2016, that's what the Supreme Court Justice was telling Drudge. Get ready. It's all going to start next year. And it is. They're going from beta to 1.0. That means New World Order. This is it. We are in the New World Order. We have crossed the line as of right now. Mark the date. 9/1. September 1st, 2016. They've turned on the technocracy, the world government. And I've got all the articles in front of me where the internet censorship is exploding, where Germany's getting ready to collapse. They are rolling their whole thing out. They are censoring. When a guy saves a baby and is a hero, they blur the Trump off his shirt on the news. I mean, they have armies of sycophant humans who are busily selling out their fellow humans, thinking they're going to get a slot at the table. Even though they're setting up automated algorithm AI systems to replace them. It'd be like if you were a chef that was cooking for cannibals and your food stock was you know, a pen of 30 or 40 people, and some of them were your family in there, but that's okay. And every day you knock somebody else on the head, and then you know, they bring them in and you cut them up, and then you cook them and you serve them to your masters upstairs. You don't ever really get a look at. You just kind of send the plates on, you know, through a conveyor belt, and something in there eats them. And then finally, one day, you get your little teletype out, you know, telling you, we want you to train this individual to help us cook, to prepare the meat, to prepare the feast. And you say, well, I'm the chef. I don't need any help. Oh, just please train this new chef, because we've been looking at you and we think you're fattened up now and it's time to eat you too. And you dumbasses are sitting there with a pen of your fellow humans that you're serving up, and you don't understand you're next on the conveyor belt because you've been taught how to be a synthetic sociopath or psychopath. That's what all this TV and murder and the simulations and, you know, the shoot 'em up games and all of it, and the degradation, the movies and the TV, is just to get everybody ready to accept the implosion of the human condition. I'm really blown away by the social engineers, and I mean, they've got a really, really nasty, nasty, nasty comportment. They are the type of people that grab your kid out of the backyard and torture him for a month in a dungeon. I mean, that's what we're dealing with here. And it's come out in Europe where the top politicians and leaders have like basements with toddlers they torture for months and rape and kill. I mean, you're like, what in the world are you? That's who runs things. And to them, it's pretty to see breast cancer up a couple thousand percentage points. It's fun to see autism up tens of thousands of percentage points. It's fun to see the once great and mighty human condition brought low and to see us stumbling around shuffling zombies. I just can't believe it. And where are the men? Where are the people standing up? And it's here. It's on. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of articles a day from the establishment on how they're going to censor and how they are censoring and how glorious it is. And maybe we should start arresting people we disagree with. Oh, yeah, let's do it. Oh, yeah, that sounds fun. And it's weird, like the zombie trendies and stuff are in a haze, and they've got this operating system of tyranny now, and they're getting off on it, and you see them hopping around, like just feeling the evil, and they're like, oh, this feels good. Other people know what's going on. They decide to punch out. They decide to clock out. They decide to try to escape because they can't handle it. I get it. Problem is, there's nowhere to punch out to. We come back. I'm gonna get more into the news. I'm going to play the amazingly historic and presidential speech of Donald J. Trump in Mexico, a very honorable speech. Just telling the Mexicans, look, I can't come down here and do whatever I want. You have your sovereignty. We have ours. We're all being screwed over by the multinationals. Let's work together. Trump believes in humanity. Trump believes he can give you a sophisticated argument. Trump believes he can talk about the real players and what's really happening. Trump is betting on that. Because, see, the globalists feed disinfo and low-grade information out to dumb people down. The whole program is in the message. What's in the message isn't even that important, only that it be twisted and screwed up and full of garbage so that we just become a bunch of mindless idiots. But instead, Donald Trump believes people can actually understand what's going on and what's happening. That's coming up. The censorship news is over the top. They're going to bring, I told you they were going to do this, but because they've announced it. I mean, Zuckerberg's been studying it. They're announcing, Google is, Chinese-style net censorship here in the U.S. It's been announced. It's now official. And a world government with a cashless society control grid is only getting started. The crimes were like little waves on a pond compared to a tsunami. Hell itself will manifest on this planet if their program is allowed to be carried out. The Bible says if God didn't intervene, there would be no flesh left on the earth. No flesh left. And now the technology is there to do exactly that. I want to get to all this news. It's such a heavy news day. So many incredibly important clips, the most important ever. But I just want to let everybody know, the globalists tend to launch major operations, give New World Order speeches on September 1st. I just walked into the office and talked to some of the guys, and I said, a major jump in activity, the likes of which we've never seen, the coordination, the globalists admitting they're launching a lot of new big initiatives. This is the global push. And you know, it hit me that when we talk about them stealing the election, and we talk about the Justice Department and Homeland Security saying it's going to come in and run the election now, but Donald Trump's a kook for saying they would do that a month ago. You're like, where's the logic in that? It's a war on logic. These people are just totally turned over to lies. And it's one unified spectrum of deception, whether it's CNN or whether it's MSNBC or NPR, and they just spew an entire false reality. And their minions go with it in lockstep, and no one reports on the new emails pouring out daily. There's new ones. They're on Infowars.com where Nancy Pelosi admits that ISIS is Al-Qaeda and it's U.S. policy to use them in the Middle East to take over countries. Now, we already knew that. Cy Hirsch has come out with that. And I just use that as a credibility point. We broke it. You broke it. You pushed it. Drudge put it out. It's true. It's like going into a bar and, you know, some guy's playing darts and puts all five darts right in the bullseye. And you go, that guy's a terrible dart player. Yeah, that'd be a satire joke, wouldn't it? But the public would believe it if they're in that zombified condition. Yes, you're a terrible dart player. Amazing. So, looking at this, let me show you what's emblematic before I come back and get into all the censorship and then play Trump's speech. What's emblematic? Watch Headline News, who just fired Dr. Drew because he dared come out and say Hillary needs to be assessed. HLN blurs out Trump on man's t-shirt who saved baby from hot car. When they rebroadcast it. Isn't that just special? That's what they're doing, ladies and gentlemen. And this story came out in October of 2015. And BBC and others pitched it like it was no big deal. Total control over the internet, creating electronic ghettos where you can't even make money on the internet or have a job in the physical third dimension. If you criticize the government of corporations, YouTube and Google are now announcing this system. In the terms of service, it's happening. Zuckerberg has been coordinating with the Chinese communists as well. All right, let me plunge into the news now and get into the Trump speech and a lot more. Before I go any further, I'm not going to sit here and do a long pitch. I've just gotten to the point where I want to thank the listeners and viewers that understand that they're trying to censor everyone and shut everybody's advertising money off and bankrupt talk radio and take over Fox News. And we have their own memos and Hillary Clinton coming out in her fundraising emails. This isn't even secret, saying we're going to shut down the alt media, starting with Breitbart. This is outrageous. And instead, they've got pundits on TV going, yeah, that's great. They don't have a right to exist. The refrain now when we go out and cover anti-Trump rallies is Alex Jones needs to die. Donald Trump needs to die. And it's always super weak, pathetic people that just want to throw around talk of killing. It's so historic. It's got all the telltale signs of society about to go completely belly up. And again, Germany says brace for a giant emergency. The German government does. We write a story about it and people go, oh, you're fear-mongering. I'm fear-mongering? German banks are teetering on the verge of collapse. That's mainstream German news. That'll make Lehman Brothers in 2007 and 2008 look like a breeze, a summer breeze compared to a typhoon, a hurricane, a tempest, a maelstrom. You can see it intellectually. You can feel it. I told you building up the last few years, my concern, my spirit has been really concerned 5 times, whatever it was, 10 times, 20 times. It's now just full blast. Spider sense is, oh my God. And then I can look at it happening. And you can look at the headlines and what they're doing and how they're pitching it. And then you can go, oh, let me go actually read what Devo said about this 3 years ago. And you go read it. And it's exactly what they're doing. I mean, but I don't even need to go read their documents anymore. I've got their plan because I've watched them lay it out. It's like they're laying out more railroad track in front of me, and I see where it's going, and I'm like, oh, my God, this is unbelievable. You talk about a highway to hell, people think of that in an AC/DC song as some fun place. No, this isn't fun where we're going. And a lot of people say, Alex, don't fearmonger, don't scare us. It's not fear-mongering. Our house is on fire. Our only hope is to admit this is going on. When I say repent, I don't mean to go to some establishment government-run church and worship some, preacher like he's God. I mean really get on our knees and repent. Just for everything going on in the world. I'll tell you what really gets to me. I, in my spirit, my gut, I feel guilty for all this stuff. And I see the evil increasing, and it's so horrible. And it also, it wants to hurt innocent people, and I just feel like I'm on fire to resist it. I mean, I don't know how else to describe it. It's like, well, we need to fight this right now. We need to do something. And the impetus I had 25 years ago to fight, it was there, but it was more like just a push. Now it's like a torrent. And I just simply want to ignite people's gut-level instincts to see evil and to see tyranny and to see how if you're in a parking lot and some shady guys start getting around you, you go, oh my God, I'm about to get shaken down. Everybody's ever been shaken down. That's how most muggings happen. People just brandish a gun or a knife or say, we're going to beat the hell out of you, give us your money. You should do it to women. The point is, we're being surrounded and they're shaking us down. And we're going, oh, thank you, New World Order. You're so nice. Because the mainstream media continues to run this con game that what they're doing is okay. It's not okay. It's a false illusion. And people are seeing through that illusion, but they can't have any independent media out there that'll say back to the public, yes, you're right. What you see is wrong. 6% trust rate in mainstream media. So that's where all this is going. I'm not going to belabor it. We sell the very best products, the very best nutraceuticals out there at very, very low prices. We have the best selenium from our research. It's just amazing for the mustard seed, such a key element. Just go research selenium for yourself and then realize why you want BioTrue selenium from InfoWarsLife.com. Everybody needs multivitamins, and most of them are synthetic or you don't absorb them. We set out, it took us 2.5+ years to develop it. It's proprietary, plant-derived, vitamin mineral fusion with the amino acids and other cofactors. Great way to get your kids, to be healthier and to actually absorb their multivitamin. A true game changer. Available at InfoWarsLife.com. To spread the word, we have the Hillary for Prison shirts that are at cost, $9.95. That includes shipping. $9.95 is what it cost us to print them, ship them out the door to your door. InfoWarsStore.com. is the umbrella site. And then that funds the running of this media operation. What you can see is changing the world because you are changing the world. But more importantly than even buying the products, I do ask for your prayers. And I do ask that you make sure that all of our efforts are not in vain and that you send out the videos, the articles, the information we put out, and that you save it and you make copies of it and you share it with people. And we need a desperation. And people always misinterpret the term desperation and just think of somebody who's totally given up on an island, is going to starve to death, and then they have desperation. It's larger than that, and I forget whoever one of the most famous samurais was, but I've quoted the quote many times, that the way of the samurai is desperate. And that means in a fight, like everything you've got, you're desperate. You're desperate to get the car off your little kid. And people see some 60-year-old woman, you know, lift a car off. Police have seen that many times, firefighters, you name it. Like, how the hell did you do that? And it's because the governor switches off. We have to get desperate, people. We're in desperate straits, and the system laughs and giggles and makes fun of everything and tries to transmute us being concerned into that. But I'm personally so on fire with concern. It's like 69 degrees in here, and I'm sweating. Because my body is on fire with the desperation of trying to get people out of their trance. Now, I'm going to go to the Trump clip in a moment. I'm going to skip the network break coming up so we have time. But it's here. The censorship's happening. It's intensifying. They say they're coming for us. They have attorney generals meeting, wanting to arrest people that deny man-made climate change. They are persecuting people in the schools. They're annihilating free speech. They're blurring Trump shirts on TV when they invite someone on as a guest who's a hero. It is total management crafting. It is propaganda to the 10th level. Remember 2 years ago, Congress, quote, legalized the CIA involved in domestic propaganda? And then the Deputy Secretary of Defense came out and gave a speech to the military and civilian psychological warfare group, 45-minute long speech. I played it. And they talked about the Drudge effect, and they said, we can't lie anymore because we'll get caught by the internet, Drudge being emblematic of that. And it cut to the people in the audience, and the older ones looked completely sick because they knew what this really was. This was the announcement of, we're going operational here domestically, and you're going to go out and do it. But then they had some younger people that were in PR and you know, writing for armed services publications, get up and go, this is great, because I really don't like having to lie to people. And they're like, oh, thank you. She doesn't quite get it, does she? She's like, oh, we're going to tell the truth now. But it goes further than that, because at that very time, large sections of the military were actually refusing to go along with it. So see, what they even claimed they were doing, even though it was a psyop, backfired. Because at this point, with a general population that is in a trance, won't stand up for anybody, including themselves, who's the only group they know that as twisted and screwed up in many cases as they are, like all of us? The military. They're phasing the military out right now. They're bringing in automation. They're bringing in machines. They've got all the movies and video games priming the little girls to not be princesses or doctors or, no, you're going to be a soldier now. You're going to be a technocrat. And I was just thinking about how they're installing dictators in Italy and in other countries like Greece, where they actually put Goldman Sachs presidents and Goldman Sachs directors in, and they say, oh, we call this technocracy when we install someone. I remember that major bankhead when I was on the airplane off record, where I'd tell you his name, just looking at me and going, Alex, the big banks know how to run things better, and soon we're going to run everything. And you think the public's going to adapt and wake up and fight this? No, they're going to adapt to submitting to it. Because basically, humanity's done. And he had the perfect hair and the perfect smug face and the perfect suit that didn't even look wrinkled after a 3.5 hour flight from Austin to New York. And he got his black trench coat and put it over his arm and just laughed at me. But in my hours of conversation with him, sitting in first class right beside me, when he talked about his dad, a general who he was visiting in San Antonio, you know, he looked like he loved his dad and had this look in his eye. Yeah, my dad's getting old. This guy would look like he was about 60. And it's like you care about your dad, but you don't care about the general public because you think they're stupid. But the ruling engineers admit they designed it to make people even stupider than they already would be. So you care about your daddy, but you don't care about people around you who aren't your family. So you're not a psychopath. You're an arrogant person that just wants power. You're a control freak. And you better hope there's not a hell, buddy boy. And I'll assure you there is. One dimension over, sweetie pie. One jump. And you're not going to be here anymore. When you go through that portal that atheists and everybody else go through, and every person from every culture throughout time says they see when you die, you're going to have to go be with people like you. That's all. You just go like a magnet to who you are. You want to be like this at the next level? When we graduate from this level, that's how the universe works. When we go to the next level, you don't want to go to the next level, do you? You want to go down a level, don't you? They call that hell. Now, it's hell because there's people like you in it. You make it hell. You and your hate and your greed and your weakness and your dishonor consume yourselves. You're your own kindling. It's metaphysical. It's archetypal. It's poetry in motion. I want to play the incredible Trump speech here, and then we've got a bunch of big guests they haven't even gotten to. They're being censored, you name it. I've got the Chinese-style social credit. Oh, it's a social credit. If you criticize government or corporations, we just don't let you operate on the internet anymore, and you get a low score, and then you physically can't have a job either. Mark of the beast. What it is, mark of the beast. If you're not a good little globalist, you'll be able to use the internet. And that's what YouTube has announced their beginning. Oh, if we decide, if the social community diversity team is what it's called, people complain, and then we decide in the little proletariat meeting, in a little commissar meeting, then you don't get to make money on your channel anymore. We're going to make money on it and break our deal with you. They were always planning this. Carrot of the stick. Now, Donald Trump, the statesman, the pure presidential material, the man, not a faker. It's like David fighting Goliath. He, I guess, would be King David. But we don't want to be blessed, do we? No, we want Jezebel. That's what we want. And boy, if she doesn't fit the bill of Jezebel, perfectly tailored, nobody does. He goes to Mexico, and I said yesterday, and Trump didn't get this from me. Trump understands the battle better than I do. And I said, we don't know what he's going to say in Mexico. There's a big news item. No one knows what he's going to say. And I said yesterday, over and over again, I said, he goes down there. He needs to say, let's fight the New World Order and globalism together. Let's come together. Let's defeat this. Let's not be controlled by multinationals. Let's have America and Mexico, neighbors, team up to build each other up. Same thing he's saying to Russia. And they took this olive branch and the media spun it. It was a horrible thing. And he did say, I'm sovereign. You're sovereign. America's sovereign. We can't do this. People just can't come over to Mexico and do whatever they want. And it's the same thing here. You know that's common sense. He talked to the public. He talked to the Americans, the people of the world, but directly to the Mexicans, and said, I don't think you're stupid. I'm not going to dumb this argument down. Here is Donald Trump's address in Mexico yesterday before he got on a plane and went and gave a bunch of other speeches. Here's this.
Let us now hear the words of the Republican candidate to the presidency of the United States of America, Mr. Donald Trump.
Thank you. It is a great honor to be invited by you, Mr. President. A great, great honor. Thank you. We had a very substantive, direct, and constructive exchange of ideas over quite a period of time. I was straightforward in presenting my views about the impacts of current trade and immigration policies on the United States. As you know, I love the United States very much, and we want to make sure that the people of the United States are very well protected. You equally expressed your feelings and your love for Mexico. The United States and Mexico share a 2,000-mile border, a half a trillion dollars in annual trade, and 1 million legal border crossings each and every day. We are united by our support for democracy, a great love for our people, and the contributions of millions of Mexican Americans to the United States. And I happen to have a tremendous feeling for Mexican Americans, not only in terms of friendships, but in terms of the tremendous numbers that I employ in the United States. And they are amazing people, amazing people. I have many friends, so many friends, and so many friends coming to Mexico and in Mexico. I am proud to say how many people I employ. And the United States, first, second, and third generation Mexicans are just beyond reproach. Spectacular, spectacular, hardworking people. I have such great respect for them and their strong values of family, faith, and community. We all share a common interest in keeping our hemisphere safe, prosperous, and free. No one wins in either country when human smugglers and drug traffickers prey on innocent people, when cartels commit acts of violence, when illegal weapons and cash flow from the United States into Mexico, or when migrants from Central America make the dangerous trek, and it is very, very dangerous, into Mexico or the United States without legal authorization. I shared my strong view that NAFTA has been a far greater benefit to Mexico than it has been to the United States, and that it must be improved upon to make sure that workers, and so important, in both countries benefit from fair and reciprocal trade. I expressed that to the United States and in that of the United States that we must take action to stem this tremendous outflow of jobs from our country. It's happening every day. It's getting worse and worse and worse, and we have to stop it. Prosperity and happiness in both of our countries will increase if we work together on the following five shared goals. Number one, ending illegal immigration, not just between our two countries, but including the illegal immigration and migration from Central and South Americans and from other regions that impact security and finances in both Mexico and the United States. This is a humanitarian disaster. The dangerous treks, the abuse by gangs and cartels, and the extreme physical dangers. And it must be solved. It must be solved quickly. Not fair to the people anywhere worldwide, you can truly say, but certainly not fair to the people of Mexico or the people of the United States. Number two, having a secure border is a sovereign right and mutually beneficial. We recognize and respect the right of either country to build a physical barrier or wall on any of its borders to stop the illegal movement of people, drugs, and weapons. Cooperation toward achieving this shared objective, and it will be shared, of safety for all citizens is paramount to both the United States and to Mexico. Number three, dismantling drug cartels.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've got to hit pause here because of developments. I knew that Matt Lauer was doing the so-called debate, and I predicted on air that they were going to somehow try to cancel the debates. And if this is accurate, and Daily Caller is very accurate, and I'm going over their sources here. In fact, it's been announced by the debate commission. They've canceled the debate is what this is. But in an exercise in brainwashing, even alternative media doesn't get what the headline should be. They're going to be on different stages, back to back, to control it in case Trump says something they don't want said. This is unbelievable. I mean, we knew he'd destroy her. This is how rigged it is. They've already installed leaders in Europe. The globalists have already stolen all these elections. They've got Homeland Security taking over the election. They're saying they want to censor the press, and now it's on drudgereport.com. We're putting it on Infowars.com. Matt Lauer will moderate first forum between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. Wow. But then it's not that. And this is being reported by NBC News, along with the Iraq and Afghanistan. This is insane. It will be a one-hour forum where Clinton and Trump will answer questions about national security. Now it's an hour. Should be 2 hours. Oh, my gosh. It will be a one-hour forum where Clinton and Trump will answer questions about national security, military affairs, and veterans issues in front of an audience mainly made up of members of the military. The two candidates will not be on stage at the same time, but will instead go back-to-back. They're going to have him look like the military attacks Trump. Oh, my God, this is a psyop. He's walking into a trap. And they're doing this so he'll, quote, cancel, saying it's not a real debate, because it's not a debate. And then they'll say he's a sore loser. I mean, they're asking him to get in a boxing match when the other guy's got a machine gun. It will be a one-hour forum where Clinton and Trump will answer questions about national security. The two candidates will not be on the stage at the same time, but will instead go back to back. And, of course, the media is making it all about how he's on the Clinton Foundation Global Initiative payroll. He works with them. But that's not even the issue. That's a big issue, but back to back. They're not even going, oh, she's definitely got something wrong with her. She cannot even be out there for an hour. Instead, we'll go back to back. That means one goes on for 30 minutes. That's all she can handle. And then Trump comes in. Print me every article, every debate commission statement on this. This is the number one story right now. I am physically cannot handle it. And by that, I mean physically, it feels like it's even wrong to be here on air calmly talking about this. I mean, this is outrageous. We should be in the streets. And their strength is our weakness. I look at how their supporters are these lazy, stupid zombies and politically correct morons and dumbed-down buffoons and empty-headed victims of this system. I wish I could reach these people. I mean, I'm not calling them stupid to feel powerful. The globalists have made them dumb so they can be ruled over, but still they're like dangerous piranha. We'll be right back, folks. Second hour. There's so much coming up. They're launching the takeover, folks. This is more proof. This is Soviet Union level crap, okay?
Of safety for all citizens is paramount to both the United States and to Mexico. Number three, dismantling drug cartels and ending the movement of illegal drugs, weapons, and funds across our border. This can only be done with cooperation, intelligence and intelligence sharing, and joint operations between our two countries. It's the only way it's going to happen. Improving NAFTA, number four. NAFTA is a 22-year-old agreement that must be updated to reflect the realities of today. There are many improvements that could be made that would make both Mexico and the United States stronger and keep industry in our hemisphere. We have tremendous competition from China and from all over the world. Keep it in our hemisphere. Workers in both of our countries need a pay raise very desperately. In the United States, it's been 18 years. 18 years. Wages are going down. Improving pay standards and working conditions will create better results for all, and all workers in particular. There's a lot of value that can be created for both countries by working beautifully together, and that I am sure will happen. Number five, keep manufacturing wealth in our hemisphere. When jobs leave Mexico, the U.S. or Central America and go overseas, it increases poverty and pressure on social services, as well as pressures on cross-border migration. Tremendous pressure. The bond between our two countries is deep and sincere, and both our nations benefit from a close and honest relationship between our two governments. A strong, prosperous, and vibrant Mexico is in the best interests of the United States and will keep and help keep for a long, long period of time America together. Both of our countries will work together for mutual good and, most importantly, for the mutual good of our people. Mr. President, I want to thank you. It's been a tremendous honor, and I call you a friend. Thank you.
That was a very, very serious olive branch. It was common sense. It's what Trump really represents. But when America's been walked all over, I mean, there are more Chinese a week coming in than there are Mexicans, and they admit they come here, and CNN reports on like it's a good thing to have babies free and to get citizenship. And the articles, when you read them, say, strangely, it's mainly wealthy Chinese. Well, yeah, we've got better hospitals. And you just come on a couple-month vacation, and you have your baby, and it's all paid for. And then the baby's a citizen. Nobody else lets you do that. But Germany and places like that, because they're absolutely trying to bankrupt and create division. That's wrong. I can't go to China and get stuff free. It's not racist. And I'm not even going to play race card on that issue. I mean, I could. Like, I'll hypothetically play it. And I'm not racist against Asians. My sister's Korean, adopted. I love Asians. Of course I do. Point is, I don't have to sit there and preface it with that. But you know, I show up in China and say I have my baby free, they would arrest me. If you smart off the Chinese police, they cut your testicles off in the street. Seriously, look it up. They walk you over, cut your testicles off. That's what they do. Look it up. All right, drudgereport.com has a Daily Caller article linked up that the first debate isn't a debate at all. It's an event where Hillary goes back to back with Trump, two different stages, and they take basically pre-screened questions. You can bet your bottom dollar on that. Now, they said they're going to have other debates that'll be actual debates. We'll see if that happens, because she never goes out on stage more than 15, 20 minutes, and she never speaks more than about 8 minutes. Now, I've got somebody who I'm a huge fan of. I know most of you are probably fans. I know Buckley here in the office is a huge fan. And years ago, would hang Dilbert cartoons on his wall. In fact, I had a whole wall of them. Dilbert creator endorses Hillary out of fear for personal safety. Remember that article that Don Salazar wrote back on June 6th? So many death threats, so many attacks. Okay, I will support her. You bet. Please back off. And, of course, that's tongue-in-cheek in my view. We're going to talk to the man himself here in just a moment. But imagine even his lighthearted cartoons got massive threats. Can you imagine the threats we get? Can you imagine? I've never seen this level of behavior. And the New York Times calling for Donald Trump to be killed. So I thought we'd play a little boil down, because why this guy's even more interesting, not just for his cartoons, But all the predictions he's made that have come true, sometimes decades before, really uncanny. So obviously a smart guy. We're going to be going to him here in just a moment. Here's a short boil down of Scott Adams, the creator and artist behind Dilbert, looking into his crystal ball.
Joining me to talk Trump is Scott Adams. He's the creator of Dilbert. Again, Scott, on his blog, has been analyzing the rise of the Republican frontrunner for months now. And frankly, he has some of the most interesting and accurate observations about why Trump is appealing to so many people.
And I called him to be the landslide winner in the general election last year, because the tools he's using, essentially, he's basically taking a flamethrower to a stick fight. There's nobody using the same tools he's using.
So you have another theory about Trump saying that he uses certain words and almost hypnotizes the audience. What do you mean by that?
So, for background, I'm a trained hypnotist, and I've been studying persuasion all of my life as part of what I do for a living as a writer. And I noticed back in August of last year that Trump was using persuasion techniques to perfection when it looked like he was just a crazy clown saying random things. But if you look at his method from a trained persuader's point of view, it's been perfection from the beginning. It just looks random to someone who's not trained in how to persuade. His complete ignoring of facts are actually part of the persuasion, because he doesn't give you targets, he doesn't give you details of his policies usually. So he's reducing the number of targets while making you feel good and focus on the things he wants. So it's not about facts, it's about focus and attention.
Is this like what you're talking about when you say like the linguistic kill shot, whether calling Jeb Bush low energy or something else?
Yeah, so the linguistic kill shot is finding some kind of insult, if you can call it that, that sticks like other insults would not. And he likes to pick things that are visual. You look at the person and say, yeah, that feels kind of right. But he also picks words and phrases that haven't been used before, so they haven't been polluted by other meaning, which is a good technique. So when you say somebody's low energy, there's nobody else that you ever talked about like that. When I heard low energy, I called...
Low energy, right.
Yeah, I called the end of Bush that day. Because that is a sticky insult. So these are not random insults.
I'm not saying they're random. I'm not saying they don't work. I'm just saying he brands people. Well, low energy, crazy, crooked.
No, but there's something else to it. He's working on confirmation bias. When you see anything come out in the news that looks like maybe Hillary Clinton did something a little bit suspicious, you say, crooked Hillary. The brilliant thing he did recently was he came up with a second one for Clinton. He said, well, is she heartless? Is it a heartless Hillary? Or is it crooked Hillary? And he actually made people debate whether she was more heartless or more crooked. And that's all intentional. This is all technique.
Democrats like to say that they'd love to run against Trump. You clearly think that they're underestimating him.
Yeah, based on his talent stack alone, if you look at any individual talent he has, you could say, well, that's not the best in the world. But look how many he's put together. He knows strategy, business strategy. He knows negotiating. He's the best persuader I've ever seen. He's quick on his feet. He's funny. He's smart enough. He knows enough about politics. So when you put that stack together, nobody really stands up to that stack. I've been predicting he's going to win in a landslide since last year.
Not just the nomination, but the presidency.
Yeah, I think it'll be one of the biggest margins of victory in history.
There you go. Now Scott Adams joins us. Scott, I've got to say that I think a lot of what you would call trained programming is actually just instinctive in alpha males and leaders. And sure, he's gotten better at it and made it more technical over the years as a manager and a salesman. But people think all the time I'm doing trained stuff. I was never trained in anything. I really mean what I'm saying. I think the missing element of what you were saying there is, it is true she's crooked. It is true she's obviously got health problems. Even Obama's doctor. I mean, I think what really makes Trump powerful is that he's telling the truth. And yes, sometimes he does simplify it. What do you say, Scott Adams, creator of Dilbert, blog.dilbert.com?
Well, people can't tell the difference between the truth and something that's totally made up. That is one of the powers we don't possess. What we do instead, and this is something you need to understand to be a hypnotist, is that people are irrational all the time. So what we really think is truth is usually confirmation bias. Now, things can be true also by coincidence, but usually we individuals don't have access to the base facts. We're just hearing it from somebody else. We're putting it together from clues in our environment. So most of what we recognize to be truth is really just confirmation bias. And this is true on both sides, by the way.
I agree for the general dumbed down public. But I mean, we deal in the real, I mean, I do, the real system, the real program of how culture is set up and operating and the different competing systems. And I find Trump to be very, very accurate, very, very on target. I mean, his speech in Mexico, that had a lot of facts in it.
It did, and that's part of his persuasion. Because if you look at what the other side was trying to do to him, they're persuaders, and I think there's one in particular who's probably behind it. I've speculated that Robert Cialdini, who's famous for writing the book Influence, who would be one of the best influencers in the world, might be consulting for Clinton. He did help Obama's campaign, so it would be odd if he wasn't helping this time as well. But the situation that they'd set up is a confirmation bias trap that they built around Trump that made his opponents think that everything he did was one of these things. It's either crazy or uninformed, or it's racist, or it's another sign of his thin skin and his bad temperament. So they've set up a bunch of confirmation bias traps that everything he does can be interpreted to be one of those things if you're already inclined to think that way. So that's how persuasion works. Now, it's the same technique that Trump uses in the other direction. But so what he needed to do to try to wiggle out of that trap is try to do anything that showed he is well-informed, at least on one topic. And I think having 10 bullet points and talking about it for, I don't know, how long he talked, 45 minutes or an hour, I think he sold that. So the people who said Trump can't learn, he doesn't care about the details, he's not serious.
Wasn't it a daring and really smart move to go to New Orleans and the flooding when Hillary wouldn't, to go to Mexico and then say, you know, get down here, Hillary?
Yeah, that's great optics, because he's also working on the impression, which he's created, that Hillary doesn't have the stamina.
Plus, it looks presidential when he's standing next to a president.
Yeah, so he's got all the optics right. And that also works toward the, is he a crazy racist? Because you see him talking to the president of Mexico, and the two of them are getting along fine. You know, it didn't turn into a slap fight. You know,
the Mexican president's body language after the meeting was he really suddenly liked Trump.
Well, everything I hear about Trump in person is that people do like him in person. His personality is a little bit different in public, and it's even different again at a rally than it is at a press conference.
Yeah, so no, Trump, the Trump people see on the trail and stuff is Trump, but the Trump behind the scenes is like, I mean, the guy's got amazing charisma, and he's very smart.
That's what I hear. And by the way, the definition of charisma, according to the scientists, is kind of interesting. Charisma, say the experts, is a combination of power plus empathy. Now, he's already got the power, so people already saw that. And if they didn't see that, they saw him just annihilate the competitors in the primaries. And so now they believe he has power.
Hey, can't we have this guy's president? I mean, this is awesome. He's got to be president.
But hold on. Part two. Part two is where his problem was. He had the power for charisma, but he lacked the empathy because he was taking a hard-nosed approach to immigration and other topics. And so that made him look like, well, maybe he's a little scary.
But don't you think that's the tactic, is to be, you know, the good cop, bad cop? He's first the bad cop, now he's the good cop.
I think he needed a different tactic in the primaries, of course, and he needed to soften it in the general, and he's well on his way to doing that. So I think his immigration speech was a huge step.
Well, sure, Scott Adams, I would love to have you on sometime just about your, you know, the technicals, being a hypnotist, you know, all your amazing you know, comics, Dilbert.com, blog.dilbert.com. But specifically, though, you saying you got so many threats, so you endorsed Hillary, and I can see here you're kind of, I don't want to say riding the rail, but I think you like Trump. I mean, I think it's obvious that you want Trump to be president, but in this media climate of censorship and persecution, you're just giving him backhanded compliments.
That's not exactly true. I'm actually completely serious when I say that I'm endorsing Hillary Clinton for my physical safety, and it's working. So prior to saying that publicly, I was getting comments online, mostly on Twitter, comparing me to Joseph Goebbels, you know, Hitler's PR person.
And but in reality, it's Nazi Germany where you have to endorse Hitler or Hitler comes after you.
Yeah, you could make that argument. But the point is that if I wanted to talk about Trump's persuasion skills, which is the thing that interested me and my audience, I couldn't do that with physical safety if people imagined that that also meant I backed his policies. And so let me say as clearly as I can that my personal political preferences don't align with either Clinton or Trump. I'm not very close to either of them on anything. So if you say, who would I prefer to be president on an entertainment basis? Of course, Trump. On a policy basis, I'm not smart enough to know who's got the best policies.
Bottom line, they're creating a new McCarthyism, but with no teeth, claiming that everyone, I mean, Hillary has actually said in her speech when she attacked myself and others last week, that the alt-right and Breitbart and others and Trump actually take orders from Vladimir Putin. I mean, I've never been to Russia. It's total bull. I've been on Russian TV. I've been on Japanese TV and British TV more than Russian TV. I'm not taking orders from the British either. I've been on Mexican TV. I'm not taking orders from the Mexicans. I mean, this is a new level. Talk about conspiracy theories. And then she made up stuff that I supposedly stand for or twisted it and then said, what type of dark heart? In fact, I want to play this clip for you. What type of dark heart does Alex Jones have and clutched her heart? Clearly, it was scripted. I want to ask you, as a top hypnotist, I know you're famous for that as well, what you think of this bit of propaganda. Here it is.
What happens in somebody's mind or how dark their heart must be to say things like that? But Trump doesn't challenge these lies. He actually went on Jones's show and said, your reputation is amazing. I will not let you down. This from the man who wants to be president of the United States.
And I'm told we haven't found it yet, but I got tweets and calls about it. Obama shot his mouth off at some dinner about me last night. But, I mean, this is really getting weird when she's talking about dark hearts and clutching her heart. I mean, what do you make of that neuro-linguistic programming?
So you notice that right after the GOP convention, as soon as Trump got done talking, all the pundits started using the same word, dark. That's not a coincidence. That comes from somebody who's trained in persuasion on their side. And again, it's probably Cialdini. And what dark does is it primes you. And this is something Cialdini writes about in his new book called Persuasion, which is coming out in a few weeks, and you should definitely buy it if you want to understand anything about the election. It sort of primes the viewer for anything that comes after fitting the mold of dark. So it's a linguistic kill shot of its own type, and it primes you to see everything in this tinged dark way. But you notice that 6 months ago, Clinton's selling points were she's the one with the experience and the facts and the, you know, she's the rational one.
The history, she's the safe one, she's the steady hand, even though she starts all these illegal wars and creates failed states. Let's expand on that, because Assange, we have this clip coming up later after you leave us, but it's on Infowars.com. WikiLeaks did a New York Times interview, and he said, listen, this woman's a demon. I've got the email. She's super dangerous. She's a mobster. She's going to hang the press, because they are. I've got stacks. She said in a campaign letter, they're going to shut down the alt-conservatives. I mean, this is bold. I'm holding the Daily Caller article with the snippets of the email right here. They actually say we have no right to exist. Talk about Hitlerian. Talk about Final Solution. And Assange says, he finally gave a hint. He said, well, a lot of it is how they're coordinating everything. It's all coordinated. Well, the earlier emails show that, where they're ordering everybody exactly what to do. I mean, this is not what you have in a free society.
Well, let me say, you're talking maybe about the WikiLeaks memo about CNN and their producers talking in advance before the interviews. That's what you're talking about.
There's a bunch of them. There's thousands of these emails, yes. But right. Coordinating what to do. I mean, you pointed out how within 1 minute of the end of Trump's speech, it was dark, dark, dark everywhere. Articles already written. These talking points go out.
All right. But let me say, just on the point of CNN and the producers, it is normal business for them to discuss in advance what the questions are. They do that with me. They do that with most of the guests. I don't know that they would do that with the if they had one of the candidates on, there might be more preparation there, or less preparation, just so they could surprise
them. There's more coordination than that. I mean, they were like sending people to go after Trump with Bernie Sanders support, people dressed up as Bernie Sanders supporters. There's a lot of coordination. I'm not sure which email
Sure. I'm not saying that there isn't some of that going on, but there's also some confirmation bias.
Sure.
We see it where it isn't as well as where it is.
No, I hear you. And for folks that don't know about that particular term, why don't you define it for them?
So confirmation bias is where you've already made up your mind that something's true, and then any evidence you see in your environment, whether it supports that fact or not, you imagine that it does. So if, for imagine, you've decided that Trump is a racist, then if he talks about something like border security, which really doesn't have anything to do with the race, it's just something you do with all your borders all the time, every country.
Sovereignty. Then
you just say to yourself, well, that's probably another example of him being a racist because I already decided.
Sure, no, they say he wants to put gay people in prison and ship blacks back to Africa, and it's all totally made up.
Yeah, that's as made up as it could be. But on the Clinton side, there's clearly some coordination with the mainstream media, but probably a little bit, over-imagined as well.
Two years ago, Congress legalized the CIA and being involved in domestic propaganda operations. They call it propaganda placement. Well, I coined that term. They call it behavior placement. And it's Congress ruled it was illegal 10 years ago, but said stop, funding it. But it's only expanding. So I think there's deeper layers to this. But obviously, this confirmation bias, famously.
Wait a minute, you think the CIA is involved in trying to influence the election?
Oh, absolutely. Here, I mean, they've had the former CIA directors and others come out and demonize Trump. I have the Washington Post on screen. U.S. repeals propaganda ban, spreads government-made news to Americans. I mean, it's full on.
Well, the government-made news is for which purpose? I mean, that doesn't necessarily mean it's nefarious.
2 years ago, they authorized domestic PSYOP operations. It's a fact. I've interviewed the police chiefs. Everybody, Delta Force comes in with big bags of money, buys off the local mayor. It's all part of COG.
Message? For what messages? What
particular just to
message?
Be prepared during a collapse or civil emergency to go with the particular party in power. It's pre-preparation, kind of like the Nazis did in France for about 3 years before they invaded. They had almost the whole general staff already paid off, ready to stand down. The Blitzkrieg really didn't do anything. The French just stood down. And that's a historical fact. It's just not widely circulated.
Okay.
Only the British fought, and then they got beaten and sent to Dunkirk and had to have the famous naval flotilla escape.
Do you think we're close to martial law and Obama trying to retain power?
I don't think Obama's going to try to maintain power, but the establishment power structure, like Goldman Sachs, that actually installs leaders, presidents and prime ministers in Greece and Italy now, at Davos, they've called for a move to technocracy and basically installing bank heads as presidents.
I think we ought to take a look at our system of government. If you ask me, it's already changed in ways that the founders didn't plan.
Exactly. It's a soft martial law.
Well, I'm going a different direction here. I'm saying that, we're a republic by design, but because of the internet, a good idea can bubble up from any individual. If it gets viral, then the mainstream media has to pay attention to
sure.
it. And if they pay attention to it, there's a good chance it's going to become policy. So I would argue that we have devolved into something closer to a direct democracy accidentally.
Maybe a direct democracy of multinational corporations voting with their campaign contributions. But
no, but I think Trump signals the end of that model that you just described.
I agree.
He wins. So the old model, and by old, I mean sort of right now, last year is old, was that the lobbyists and the big money people were doing everything and selling it to the public as they had something to do with the decisions. But now, I think that's actually becoming true because of the internet. You can make enough noise in the internet, your argument can be good enough.
Oh, I agree. There's a giant tsunami of awakening and human empowerment coming, but there isn't a totalitarian pushback to that. That's what I was getting at. Scott Adams, really smart guy, blog.dilbert.com. I hope you'll come back with us sometime in the future. Are you still predicting a landslide for Donald J. Trump?
I am, based on technique, not policies, and it looks like Clinton's not going to make it to the end line, based on what she looked like yesterday.
So I don't think it's a conspiracy theory that she looks sick. Even Obama's former doctor, who's a Democrat, is saying she looks really bad.
Well, there's a lot of variability in her appearance, and that's what I pointed out. I'm not trying to be a doctor. I'm just making
she looks like hell. Scott Adams, one last question. Are you concerned, or have you heard Homeland Security now is going to step in and run the election for the first time ever?
What?
I'm not kidding. Look it up.
Homeland Security is going to run the election.
Yes, sir. And here's the deal. You have a normalcy bias. because you're a good guy. You don't think as evil as these people do, even though you're sophisticated and smart. I'm asking you to see that confirmation bias that's even bigger because you're not a psychopath. I really appreciate your time, sir. I look forward to speaking to you again.
All right. Thank you for having me.
Very informative guy. We'll be right back. Thought-provoking. Stay with us. Huge news straight ahead. Laura Southern is probably one of the most censored people on a regular basis that I see. And the reason she is she's eloquent, she's smart, she's attractive, and she's aggressively, in a friendly way, going out and showing what horrible bullies social justice warriors are. There was a video that we heard a few days ago that she first brought to our attention. Others have reported on it as well. And that's important to note. With this horrible woman who is a public figure, a feminist, runs a feminist organization, coming out and bullying for 6 minutes a poor taxi driver or Lyft driver. The video's on Infowars.com if you missed it. It's actually hard to watch. Her voice is like nails on a chalkboard. And the headline of the article is "Snake-like bully harasses Lyft driver over Hula Girl." That's my headline. I had it changed. It was a social justice warrior flips out over Hula Girl. But I mean, really, it's just a snake-like creature. And when you hear her hissing voice and how ignorant she is and how entitled, and then it is the definition. You could teach a college course on psychology and projection on this lady. Everything she's saying to the poor, polite man who is incredibly professional the entire time. I'm sorry. Get out of the car in about 30 seconds. You don't like the Hula Girl? Get out. That is my right to do if I don't like who's in my cab. And people need to stand up to these bullies. Now, they shut down her YouTube channel. I don't know if she's gotten it back yet, but they've shut her down on Twitter. She's been shut down for the mildest stuff. You know, you go out and show some so-called feminists marching around acting like idiots, screaming and yelling that, you know, men are all evil, and, oh, we'll just shut your channel down. And don't worry, the YouTube diversity team, we have it on screen for TV viewers, sent a message back to the bully and said, oh, yes, we looked at your video, or we looked at Laura Southern's video, and, you know, we've had her removed. And then Annalise, the bully, sends Laura Southern a tweet and says, bye-bye in French to your YouTube channel. You bully. Ah, I'm destroying your livelihood. I'm trying to cut you off reaching the people when you politely showed what a bully I am. And the bullies, the other social justice warriors that are going to manage things at YouTube, they agree. And now YouTube's come out today, drudgereport.com. We're going right to Laura. Drudgereport.com, and I got to set this up, has dead center our story that YouTube has announced new terms of service where their little social justice diversity team, if they don't like what your site says, they're going to demonetize you. They're still going to take the money. They're not going to give you your 30, 40% or whatever. So this is how they're going to enforce it. And that's the Chinese model that they brought in with this social score. The BBC thinks it's a great idea and called it a social credit system that took over the internet and monitors everything you do and tracks you. That alone is 1984. And then it basically puts you in an electronic gulag. And then they say in China, the next step is no job in the real world. So Laura Southern joins us. I appreciate her coming on. Simply amazing. TheRebel.media. Thanks for coming on. You are such an evil person.
I am an evil person. This morning you're talking about me getting censored. I'm now officially banned. I'm not sure if it's from Sky News in general, but Kay Burley's show for sure. I'm a evil racist, according to them. So that's just one other thing I'm banned from. Luckily, I still have my YouTube channel, but it's interesting. That video was shared on a very large channel, Philip DeFranco. It got more views than my video I uploaded did. And that's when they started. He's had a great relationship with YouTube for 10 years, been one of their first creators, biggest creators. As soon as he uploaded that video of Annalise saying she was a bad feminist and he never talks about this social justice stuff quite like that, they started demonetizing all his stuff and they took down 12 of his
videos. Okay, well, she was bragging she took you down for a while. I mean, was she even wrong about that? I know she tried.
She was wrong about that. What happened actually is Annalise deleted her account the night that I uploaded everything, and someone stole her Twitter account and has been uploading a bunch of stuff under Annalise's name. Although Annalise has made a lot of attempts to destroy people's lives for sharing this video, she runs her feminist group in LA where she's kicked tons of people out. She's doxing anyone who questions her. She actually ran she pimped girls out. She runs like a kind of like sex ring, and she's been revealing girls as working for her in the sex work for going against her and just destroying their life. And then she's claiming at the exact same time that she is a victim of all this horrible doxing and bullying, when that is exactly what she wanted to happen to this Lyft driver.
Ah, so she's out bullying, and then finally bullies come and take over her channel, and then basically continue acting like she's been acting. I tell you, Laura, I'm glad you can fill us in all this. Do you agree with my statement that this is just epic projection? Because people that have watched the video and heard it, she's bullying and bullying and threatening his job and just all over this poor guy and cussing at him, and then she's calling him a bully.
Oh, no.
We may have had her Skype drop for a moment. Are you back?
Just 1 minute.
That's all right. We can interview you sideways. I think she's at college during the lunch break in an office. Hardworking lady. Laura Southern is our guest. Let's go ahead and play the clip while we're getting her Skype on. This is just a portion of the hula girl. Here it is.
You thought that was adorable. You didn't think about like the pillaging of the like continent of Hawaii.
I didn't even know there was pillaging.
Oh, you didn't?
No.
Okay, so you won't get rid of the doll then? Because that was like really cute thing that you found at Goodwill.
No, I'm not going to not get rid of it because of that. I just didn't realize it was offensive anyway.
But so obviously, like, you as like a white male, you were like the least, like.
But now you're judging me. You're assuming where I'm from.
No, I'm not. I'm not judging you. Either. I'm just saying, like, that perhaps, like, you might be the person who is least hurt in this situation. I'm a passenger in your car. Like, that doll is offensive to me. But you don't want to take it down because you, like, found it at Goodwill and it was like, a good find.
By the way, while we're getting her Skype back connected, it's a famous Texas thing. I don't know why we do it. We call the road Manchaca, Manchac. Everyone in East Texas always called me Alec or Alec. They couldn't say Alex. And I know her name is Lauren, not Laura, but I'm calling her Laura Southern. It's Lauren Southern. I got a lot of stuff going on in my brain, though, obviously, folks. And we're teleprompter free here. But I wanted to have her on to talk about this, because look at all the censorship that's coming in. Look at the censorship that's intensifying. Look at the Trump guy who saved the baby in the hot car. And when they had him on CNN or headline news, CNN so mistrusted, they're trying to, you know, rebrand themselves the last 5-6 years. When they first had him on, it was live and it said Trump 2016. But the next time they re-aired it, it was gone. They had simply blurted out, like you do in the Soviet Union. So they invite you on to get their ratings, and then they disrespect you, won't even let you have what's on your shirt. I mean, if somebody had something on a shirt that I didn't want, I'd be honest with them and say, change that shirt, if it was like cuss words or something. But it's not. So you disrespect people, and you disrespect your viewers, because you're not going to let a hero be associated with Donald J. Trump. Simply par for the course. And people say, well, this will wake everybody up. You know, this has got a backfire on them. The problem is, over time, we'll just get acclimated to accepting that. I want to, since we're on this subject, play a clip that's comical from Trump that he knows is so funny, it'll be hard for them not to be able to air it, because Trump's biggest problem is they won't play large clips of what he has to say now. They do that with Hillary, but she hardly comes out from under a rock to do that. But I love this clip where he says maybe ICE will deport Hillary Clinton. And he said this after he traveled to Mexico when he went to Arizona to give a speech there. And I have to tell you, I liked what Manafort was doing for the Trump campaign, helping him, you know, get some grassroots money, some organization, stop the steal at the primary level. That's what he was really an expert at. But Stephen Bannon, and I can tell you other people close to Trump say this as well, is really responsive and is working 20 hours a day and doing an amazing, amazing job. And that comes from a lot of folks that have even been in other camps. But that just shows how they're in the Trump camp to win. So really good move there with Donald Trump to get somebody else in there that's just got the new media understanding, because this is the future. And it's kind of like it's 1912 and Trump's opening an automobile manufacturing facility. Now, will he end up being the biggest like Henry Ford? Or is he launching too early, or is he launching right on time? I mean, he believes people are ready to have nationalism and sovereignty and wealth and a program of wealth and independence. The globalists want us poor. They want to control us. They admit that. It looks like we lost Laura Southern's connection. I think her computer may have died, so we're going to move on at that point. Let's go ahead and go to this clip. Maybe ICE will deport Hillary Clinton.
We are going to triple the number of ICE deportation officers. Within ICE, I am going to create a new special deportation task force focused on identifying and quickly removing the most dangerous criminal illegal immigrants in America who have evaded justice, just like Hillary Clinton has evaded justice, okay? Maybe they'll be able to deport her.
That is presidential material right there. That's what a president looks like, acts like, and does. Stamina. Alpha male. Successful. Loves America. Loves freedom. Loves wealth for the general public. Believes in a growing pie. Drinks. And Trump's never said this. Some people that know him, he drinks gallons of milk a day, steaks, big things of vegetables, doesn't take aspirin, doesn't take vaccines, none of it. And they spun it like he's unhealthy because his doctor said, look, I could have wrote that letter better. When I write these for people, I write it real quick. But he is in really great shape for someone his age. And exercises. I mean, he's as good a shape as you get at that age. I mean, look at Trump. He's 70. I mean, he's wearing body armor, so it looks like he's a little bit fatter than he is. He's not. But it doesn't matter. Just look at him compared to Hillary. I mean, this is ridiculous. This is hands down. I mean, if Hillary was like some libertarian or patriot woman and smart and you know, I don't care if they're beautiful or not. Great. Give me a woman right now. This is really a joke. I mean, this is a gigantic joke, and they're betting the farm on the fact that she's a woman and it's this gimmick and we got to do it. Now, I want to come back after this break with an extremely powerful clip of Julian Assange when he was being interviewed by the New York Times. And, of course, the New York Times wrote an article about this and didn't, you know, get into any of these areas. And now they're calling him a kook, a loon. He puts out leaks. He puts out real info. None of it's true. They got assassins trying to, you know, climb in the window and kill him over there at the embassy in London. This is amazing. And he says, this woman is a demon. Do you understand? And all I can tell Assange is too calculated a blow a lot of times misses. I would start firing torpedoes every day. I would just Chinese water torture this and just drip, 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 drip. But I wouldn't save the best till last. I would say I would fire now. Now. Like on a Tuesday morning. So that there's no way they can cover it up rather than the weekend. And then to coordinate and say it's time to take down the demon and start your engines. Because he's like, well, if the mainstream media picks this up, she'll have to go down. She's a criminal. They're not going to pick it up or they're going to spin it. You got Nancy Pelosi emails, you know, with her national security advisor to her going, yes, our policy, ma'am, is to back Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and they're taking over, and that's what Hillary's doing. And Because, you know, behind the closed doors, they have to know what the policy is. I mean, hell, the CFR wrote articles 3 years ago saying we need Al-Qaeda. They're good. It's no secret, but the media spun it where it was something about, you know, side issue about Pelosi. It was just some little corner of the memo, not even about what it was about. It's like there's this instinct to never go with the heart of what something is. I'm not going to sit here and belabor the products. We set out to have the very best nutraceuticals, the vitamins, the minerals, the supplements that we can produce. And our new selenium that came out, BioTrue Selenium, is incredibly absorbable, absolutely amazing. And it's from the mustard seed. And just go research what selenium does, folks. It's a game changer. You need it. And we need the funds to run the operation. It's a 360 win. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. We have Hillary for Prison shirts at cost. $9.95 shipping included. By the way, we're not going to be able to fund this operation if I only plug 20 seconds each hour. Other shows plug every segment. But then every few weeks I do like a 20-minute infomercial to try to fund us. We just do things different here, and it's worked while the rest of media is going bankrupt. But I should just encourage everybody to buy the products. They really are good. History's happening with the Hillary for Prison shirt. And whereas I'd like to sell them for $19.95 and be able to fund the operation, I know that we sell 10 times more when I sell them at cost. So I'd rather lose the $10 and make no money and have these flood the streets and defeat Hillary. But it is a catch-22. So I don't sit here and calculate stuff out. I just go with my gut, and it always seems to work. God comes through. But I told them, because they couldn't figure out on the shopping cart how to have an option where you could pay full price if you wanted to. And I just said, create another page with the same shirt under another code number at $19.95. Have they done that yet? Because I've been wanting this for months, and because some people want to pay full price, and we need to create another page. Okay? People say, why are you doing this on air? I have to direct on air. I have to work all the time. I have to actually do management here on air. It's what I do. And it's like an office-wide intercom, I guess, because I keep asking for that. Everybody's great. Nobody's bad. But I really do need to get the funding. So we need to add the option for $19.95, and they keep saying, but the shopping cart won't let us do that. You know, it's like in Spinal Tap where they go, why does it go to 11? Because it makes it louder. And I go, well, just how about make it louder and just says 10? He goes, but it's 11. What I'm saying, just like when I said 15 years ago, we're going to stream live 24 hours a day and not just have it archive. And it took me a year to convince people to do that. And you heard Drudge say last year it revolutionized, because they then found in the algorithms, people don't want to go hear something that's just canned. They want to jump into something. Even if it's not live, it has the feeling of being live. And I just knew if we're dominating at that time, all these different, you know, shoutcasts and stuff was big then. If we're number one when I'm live, let's just be number one all the time by not ending. And then we're always at the top. And then we get all these new people that go to that service that was big at the time. And then we get new listeners. And then we defeat the New World Order. Anyways. I said I'd go to the Assange clip, but it's too epic to play right now. I'm going to play it coming up. It's on InfoWars.com. In fact, we should tweet this out again. This is so big. He doesn't just say she's a demon and going to put the press's heads and necks in nooses. He goes over the demographics of how asinine it is to say that Russia is running him and that Russia is running Trump. And of course, Hillary says Russia's running me. I mean, there have been hundreds of news articles, folks, over the last few years saying, I'm a Kremlin agent. The only thing Russian around here is Daria doing a fantastic job in there, and she's a veteran of the U.S. Army and a patriot. So let's get some more Russians in here. I like them. The point is we're not run by the damn Russians, okay? I'm run by my conscience. I don't want to splice babies with animals. I don't want to sell baby parts. I don't want deadly vaccines they admit on the insert can kill you becoming mandatory, as California's now done. We're in deep crap, people. And I just try to straight talk everybody. But you know what? Let's have some comedy relief first. I did take off half a day yesterday. I did go out with some friends on a boat, Tim Kennedy and some other folks from the military. And Tim caught me actually supporting Hillary Clinton, and this is what happened. So we're going to have some fun.
I like Hillary Clinton. You know, that's where I support. So, Tim Kennedy, I'm going to support Hillary right now.
No! Ah!
It didn't hurt when he did it, except he hit me and his hair slapped me like a whip. I actually had a mark from his hair hitting. It was like, pow. But he took me down nicely, so I wasn't hurt. And then there's a whole other story I'm going to tell you later. Oh, my God. It's ridiculous. Yeah, people always ask me, who are you working for? Who's behind you? I've had intelligence agency people, even from foreign governments, that wanted to come visit us. And sure, I was polite and met with them years ago. I've had our own government come and visit with me, and I've met with them. And I've had, like police chiefs and stuff come in, and they're just like, you're not the only guy doing this, are you? You got to have something else that's behind this. And no, it's called resistance. It's called history. It's called will. It's called an incredible audience that aren't just spectators, but are in the arena. The Patriots. You go to a Trump rally of every race, color, creed, go-getters, not a piece of trash on the ground. Everybody polite, nice, smart, informed. You go look at a Hillary event, it looks like the living dead. And just crazy people protesting and attacking, just all fighting with each other. It just shows what we're up against is easily defeated if we just decide to take action against it. There are a lot of folks smarter than I am. And I built the InfoWar in 21 years, and it's now changing the world because of you. Now, Julian Assange, very powerful interview he did with the New York Times, where he just drops bombshell after bombshell. First, he talks about demographics in Russia. Then he gets into Hillary, who wants to put the press's neck in a noose. And that's the point I'm at. I mean, everybody knows this. I mean, the creator of Dilbert endorsed Hillary because he was getting death threats. We have now entered this authoritarian crucible, and I'm not backing down. Here is part of Julian Assange's most powerful interview yet.
What we are drawing attention to is the amazing transformation of Hillary Clinton and the Democratic Party into being the National Security Party and the National Security Candidate by whipping up a neo-McCarthyist hysteria about Russia. Any serious analyst understands that China and the United States are the only real games in town. China has 10 times the population of Russia, 7 times the GDP. Russia has the GDP of Italy. It's interesting in that it wants to be, that it makes provocative statements and so on. It's interesting. And of course, within its own neck of the woods, countries in between Russia and China, Caucasus and so on, Russia is very significant to them. But on the world stage, Russia is a bit player. That attempted reframing by Hillary Clinton to declare media organizations that are publishing material that shows illicit behavior in the DNC to fix the election for her as somehow us being Russian agents. Similar criticism has emerged from people connected to her campaign to The Intercept, where Glenn Greenwald works. Her campaign has effectively called, and maybe even directly called, Donald Trump, the opposition leader in this case, a Russian agent. Jill Stein, the Greens Party candidate, effectively the fourth candidate in terms of numbers, has also been called a Russian agent. This is a neo-McCarthyist hysteria. What kind of press environment is this going to lead to post-election? The American press, in the American liberal press, in falling over themselves to defend Hillary Clinton, are erecting a demon that is going to put nooses around everyone's necks as soon as she wins the election, which she is almost certainly going to do.
You know, people would ask me if I liked Assange going back 8-9 years ago, and I said, yeah, I see no fault in him. And they, oh, he's a, left-wing, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, we'll see when Democrats get in what he does. And then if he goes after them when they're bad, he knows he's a hero. He is. He's a hero. And I've never, that is pure veritas, what you heard. The press climate. They are coming after the press like never before. This is the stuff that dictatorships and authoritarian regimes are made of. We're in danger.
but I'm here to remind you of who we are. We're the sons and daughters of abolitionists. Men and women who gave their lives to fight against slavery. But make no mistake about it, slavery has returned. And she is more vicious than ever before. Because this time she is colorblind. 31%. 31% of white Americans are welfare recipients. 33% of black Americans have fallen for the same rules, and 28% of the Latino community has believed the lie that the government can take care of you from the cradle to the grave. All the while losing their humanity. So when Trump talks about the lies that the Democrat Party has told and the failed policies, both in economics, education, and crime, your heart should be stirred with passion and strength to do something about it.
That is R.W. Bray, and out of all the clips from the Austin event that we were obviously there covering, that clip, I thought last week, was the most powerful, and his words are true, they're strong, but it isn't even the eloquence, it's the force behind it. The way you delivered it was so heartfelt that I talking to folks that were there, and my reporters, they said that it really, the energy in the room was so strong during that. And this declaration, basically like Moses saying, we're going to come out of this thing. And then I started just thinking back about being in a Republican family growing up, and I never heard anything racist. In fact, I heard about bad things that people done, how we had to build a free market economy to bring everybody up. And then I would run into Democrats as I grew up, and they would be so racist. And I was like, but the TV says it's the Democrats that are the anti-racist. And it's just, and it wasn't until I was like even 30, I'd been on the air years before I even started even figuring it out, because the deception is so total. I can't blame some of the Democrats and people that still buy into this, because I'm a pretty smart guy and I was fooled. So I now once you're awake, you're like, what's wrong with these idiots? But it's just people don't know history. Mm-hmm. And those that don't know history, I'm going to repeat it. R.W. Bray, I'm going to go over his amazing, his military career and all the things he's done. And he's the, engagement director of the Republican Party of Texas. I'm not going to go over it all. rwbray.com, texasgop.org. And let's be clear. I always want to be clear. I'm not lionizing the Republican Party. It's done a lot of horrible stuff, and it's certainly been involved. But that's different people. But the point is, it's not the party that they've been saying it is. Now, I've invited you here, and I'm ranting. You drove here from Houston. I want to get into this with you, and I want to give you the floor. The reason I'm so honored you just said you'd come in to see us instead of just on the phone is because I want to, you know, give folks not just 5 minutes of your speech, but people to really let you take over if you want and kind of give us a sermon on your life, your development, what took you to this point. Because I think all of us are going through this process, but how do we accelerate that in others that haven't? Thank you so much, sir.
No, thank you for having me.
Really appreciate you coming in. So take over.
First, let me tell you that my wife adores you. She's a new fan ever since you all reached out. She had never really saw it. She started reaching out looking more at your clips, and she thinks that you're phenomenal.
Well, I'm humbled. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know. I think the story kind of is very simple. The speech actually was from my heart. I think that's the only way to be able to express from a black lens the importance of us adopting Republicanism. And for me, I'm actually I'm from Louisiana originally. Consider myself a person who I evacuated from Katrina. I was in the Guard at the time, so after evacuating, I had to run back. Actually, I was called up to serve. I was given the order to find 10 families in Houston who had evacuated with me and bring them back, even though I was in Baton Rouge. So I actually had to drive to Houston, find 10 families, bring them back to Baton Rouge, and then take the mothers and the husbands who were actually Guard members to serve. So I did a month in search and rescue and 3 months of ICU. And that's where my conversion starts. Unfortunately, I didn't have the benefit of being raised in a Republican family. I was raised a Democrat.
And see, I didn't know your story, but I think for all of us, it's humanizing it, how you get to the point of this powerful speech that goes worldwide and wakes up so many people. I just knew it would be very interesting.
Yes. It's a story in and of itself, but I'll give you a fast version of it. I was taking a Black Hawk trip, and as I was taking the Black Hawk trip, we were actually looking for movement. That was our goal. We had to look for any life. It was devastating, and just devastation upon devastation. And I remember looking at the east side of New Orleans, and it was all gray, Alex. Everything was gray. So we gave up looking for life, and so we circled back around.
By gray, you mean gray water.
Just gray water, gray houses, you know.
Yeah, no heat in the flare.
Nothing. Nothing was going on. And so we got to the Riverwalk, and I saw the pilot starting to cry. And I looked down, and it's nothing but men and women who look just like me. And that's when I knew we had believed a lie. The government cannot take care of you. It was droves of African-Americans with their hands up in America looking for something to be dropped down.
I don't know the story, but let me guess. What color was the pilot?
White.
And my whole point is that we're just all human beings.
That's right.
And the way they play on this, and then even when the military goes out, you know, Obama said a few weeks ago about Louisiana again, he said, be sure, don't be racist, teams that are going in there. I have family that was there as well, who was active duty Army, but they actually brought them in on that with the helicopters, and they were there working 18 hours a day.
Oh, yeah.
I had family get really hurt there. And I tell you, it really pisses them off when they're not, when they care about everybody,
yes,
and they're being told they're racist, even as they're saving people. So, I mean, what I get from that is, don't let me put words in your mouth. Are you saying that was another big moment for you to see that?
Yes, that was a shocking moment for me. And the amazing thing is that we circled back around to the east side later on that day because you had to do footwork as well as air. So we went through the homes, you know, making the marks on the walls and whatnot. And in the rubbish of a house, I found a book called Up From Slavery by Booker T. Washington. And so I took that book, washed it off, and I had a small little tent where our area was. And at night I would read that book, and it changed my life. Booker T. Washington was a entrepreneur. He was an education advocate. He started his own university. It would be no Tuskegee Airmen if it wasn't for this guy. It would be no Tuskegee University if it wasn't for this guy. But I saw his story literally from, he went from dirt floors to marble. And he gave one of the most powerful speeches, the Atlanta Compromise, I had ever heard of in my life.
And by the way, I mean, because I have to know this history for folks that don't, and I'm not defending segregation, it was horrible, but we replaced one evil with another. It was his model and system that made black communities in many areas wealthier in the white areas, which created the institutional racism even more, and they started pushing massive class warfare between poor whites and poor blacks. And that's when LBJ and all them came in with, we're going to get the men out of the house, we're going to break these
that's
communities
right.
down, because blacks just said, okay, you're going to suppress us, we're going to create our own community.
That's right.
And so they got rid of, see, I didn't even know this, you knew all this, because mm-hmm. almost no one knows this, I'm trying to explain to people. Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
So if Americans, period, mm-hmm. would do what Booker T. Washington did, well, explain it to people then.
Yeah. So Booker T. Washington, like I said, advocate for education, he could not get the what I would call racist whites to invest at all into his.
But you do it yourself.
So he did it himself, and he went out and he got investors, Republican investors, which is exactly what I'm advocating now. I don't like for us to go around making excuses, but they.
You mean the racist, the Republican Party that founded the KKK. oh, it's the Democrats. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Those are the Democrats, and it's amazing. I love the fact that you're knowledgeable of this history. And I tried to give a brief history at the Trump rally, and
my family in Texas on my dad's side were Republicans and went through a lot of crap over it.
Wow.
In fact, I never told the stories on air because it's over the top. But you imagine East Texas being Republicans in the 40s and 50s and 60s. It was not a very.
I can only imagine.
Yeah,
I can only imagine.
But I'm a racist. As well,
yeah. Anyways. Yeah, which is why you're having me on the show.
Exactly. No, but I mean, it just shows how those that don't know history don't repeat it. The public, period, doesn't know history.
No.
Please continue with your story.
And that was my conversion. Between that experience, Katrina, obviously, and the book, seeing a black man who had it was unapologetic for being a Republican, changed my entire life. And my whole view of how I needed to advance my life. it was then I realized that I need to start getting active, and ushers in why I'm now an advocate for the Republican Party of Texas. I'm a proud advocate. I would not have I not made changes then and changed my idea of what success was, what knowledge was, what education was, and how to run my political life, I would have never had the opportunity to be able to give a speech at a Trump rally to ignite fire in millions of people. But more importantly, I'm on a show that touches millions because of you. And we have a common heart. You
know? Well, that's what Trump does, is whether it's myself or you, he gives a voice to other people that have important information. And then he's helping magnify a whole new group of people.
That's right.
To truly create real diversity of ideas and thought.
That's right.
And really not have teleprompters, but come together.
That's
and just
right.
get real. Because our country's in trouble.
Oh, yeah. And you have the energy of John Brown. I love it because I'm not sure if your listeners know who John Brown is, but John Brown was good friends with Frederick Douglass. He was a powerful abolitionist, powerful advocate, who wanted to basically end slavery at all costs, to the point he got militia to do it. He was going to overtake the entire government.
Killed,
yeah. But he wound up, white racists wound up hanging this guy for even trying to do this. But I think, I'll pray to God they never hang you, but I think the fire that you have is reminiscent of those days, and I think that's what's coming. I think there's going to be a second reconstruction, and I think it's going to happen through people who get galvanized and ignite a fire underneath their bellies to start doing something.
Yeah, the Democrats are playing total race card. You want to right back to their KKK roots. I mean, I'm not just demonizing them. They deserve it. I mean, Julian Assange is a real liberal. He says Hillary Clinton is a demon. R.W. Bray from Louisiana. I'm from right here in Texas. I'm family in East Texas, which is basically Louisiana. And we were talking earlier about wild stuff that we even told people they wouldn't believe it unless you've lived in the South, about the Democratic Party. And just if all the stupid liberals knew what we knew. This is only a 6-minute segment, long segment coming up. We'll give out the number and take calls. Let's get into those brush fires you've been setting with the Trump campaign. And preach if you want. Take over.
Yes. We've been tearing them up, Alex. We spent a lot of time in Texas dispelling the myths and lifting the veil. One of the things that we've done is, Republican parties kind of tried to take an approach where they would do outreach. Well, we changed that. We changed the language of outreach to engagement. And we figured the Democrat Party is going to integrate themselves into our communities, then the Republican Party is going to integrate themselves back into the Black community. And that's exactly what we did. And so we teamed up and collaborated with different organizations, from Black Chamber of Commerce, who were pushing entrepreneur programs, to IPEAT, which is a faith-based program. It's all about taking underprivileged men and women in the 3 to 4 and the 5th wards of Houston, which is predominantly Black, and lifting them up, giving them jobs, economically independent, hooking them up with their civic presidents to become civically involved, and teaching them the importance of integrity and standing up as men so they don't return back to the prisons. So we're actually in the communities that we once were trying to preach from afar. We're out in the streets preaching, and I think it's changing the rhetoric and the language of what people think of Republicanism. So we actively are rebranding Republicanism.
Is it right to say that the Black community, after 8 years of neglect from Obama, unemployment rate almost doubling for Black Americans, that they're ready for the wake-up call? Because that's what we see in the streets. But then I see the news, spinning it, that African-Americans don't like Trump, but the numbers even show that record numbers do.
You're absolutely right. I cannot tell you how many phone calls I've received since that speech. People have found my number somehow, and they are emailing, they are texting, they are calling me on Facebook, sending messages, and most of these individuals are Blacks. And these are African-Americans who are sick of the system. You have so many... Gay is not the new Black, number one, and that's something that I get across a lot. They'll say, hey, we don't have anything against the lesbian community or the gay community, but we don't think it's the same plight. So what do we need to do? Well, you're in the party that is not going to preach that. BLM just received over 100, I think it was 100 million from Ford. And so they're going to try and push 100 million to press Black Lives Matter. And one of the things on there, initiatives that have nothing to do with Black Lives. Black lives has nothing to do with...
It's creating victimology with a string so they can make everybody dance. They're puppet strings where you're a victim, we're the people you trust. By the way, we're going to double your unemployment.
Oh, yeah, at the same time.
I mean, that's all they're doing. They're just creating... The identity isn't who you are individually, or going out and doing all these great innovations. And that's what I go back to with what happened with... It's not that the oppression was good, but that which doesn't kill you only makes you stronger. people say, what are you doing endorsing, you know, slavery or segregation? No, no, no. My point is, like special forces, you know, people being pressured to get better, it made people innovate, where so many of the famous inventions were created by people with no education that were African because they absolutely had to survive.
That's right.
And then you see, quote, government-free handouts creating devastation.
That's right. And liberals have a way of insidiously doing that. I mean, you think about it. The top Democrat states in America are led by white liberals. There's only, if you take the top 12 states that are typically vote blue, there's only one black Democrat. So basically, yeah, we want you 94% vote, but you can't lead our party. The DNC, 94% African-Americans are voting black, but the DNC is a white liberal. And so that's just like the plantation mindset. They know how to set the crops up to harvest later. And for them, the blacks are the slaves that offer them the votes they need in order to stay in office.
Well, I'll say this, because they're going to screw over the Hispanics as well. They want cheap labor and a new, you know, permanent underclass. But right now, they're going, oh, my God, blacks are waking up.
That's
we
right.
better switch over to Hispanics. And that's why you've seen such a total abandonment.
That's right. And the sad thing is that African-Americans in those areas don't see the importance and the power of their vote. No one party should have a monopoly over the black vote. People want it. They need to earn it. And the African-Americans have given their vote over to Democrats, and they've lost their power.
Let's talk about Trump. We're going to break in a minute. But what's your, like, in-person meeting him? What's your impression?
He's just like you. Truly. He's the guy who says what he thinks. He gives it to you straight, no chaser. You got to appreciate me, a man like that. Doesn't matter. You know, we've gone to this PC world where you just can't say anything that's really on your mind. Well, that's not the way you
see right.
things moving.
Well, they claim that, you know, we want to get rid of this establishment, and Congress has a 9% approval rating, and the media has a 6%, and then here's the whole thing we hate, the whole system that we say we don't want is having conniption fits over Donald Trump. People are insane.
That's
if
right.
they don't. I mean, it's like you said, what do you have to lose? You're getting screwed over. I'm gonna make better deals. Guaranteed. It's guaranteed. We'll be right back. R.W. Bray, rwbray.com, just rwbray.com. I'm Alex Jones, your host. Again, I'm not going to belabor this. If you want to support the broadcast, support local affiliates, become a sponsor of those local stations, spread the word, paint Infowars.com on the side of your barn, put up a billboard, buy the products, great nutraceuticals like selenium that we just came out with. It's from the mustard seed, the best bioavailable form out there. It's using all electrochemical activity in the body to get all the toxins out of the cells, you name it, you die without it. People are massively, I'm going to take some right now, massively not getting enough selenium out there. Do your own research. Look into what selenium does, cancer rates, you name it. It is truly a game changer. And it fuses with iodine, but nobody's got the proper type of iodine. We have the only true nation iodine from our research that's out there. It's from a deep earth source, not from seaweed. The stuff we have would eat through three layers of steel building like in the movie Alien. I mean, that's how powerful the good halogen is. But then through a special patented Russian technique, I guess we are now Russian agents. I guess that's a Russian connection. The media's got it. It is then injected into organic palm oil and then is no longer stuff that'll eat through steel girders. And I'm just documenting for you how powerful this halogen is. It's in the same family as fluoride, chlorine, all the garbage that just inundates our environment. And you take selenium, you take this, you take enough vitamin C. We don't sell that because there's so many good sources of it out there naturally. They all work in synergy. But if you don't have one of these, you die. And deficiencies in it are just record level. Record level. Your cells don't have this. They start malfunctioning. They start mutating. There's a name for that. InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsStore.com. Or simply call toll-free 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And we also have Hillary for Prison shirts at cost, because I just want to see 100,000 of these are already out there. It's already sending shockwaves. It's all over the news constantly. It's one of the most searched terms this year on the internet. And we started it. You started it. You bought the shirts. You got them out there. You did the work. I had the idea. But it all goes together like a horse and carriage. And we have the Support the Info War. You can click and get it for $19.95 at full price if you want, where we make $10 to fund things, or $9.95 shipping included. $5 for the shirt, $5 to ship it on average. So choose $19.95 if you want to help us Or, doesn't matter, you're helping us getting it at $9.95. We're all helping each other. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com is nutraceuticals. 20% off our great vitamin mineral fusion fruit punch. From our research, again, this is the, because I always say that because there might be something better out there. And if there is, we're gonna go out and private label it. This is the best game-changing multivitamin mineral system for full absorption, or the highest level of absorption for you and your family, just like our methylcobalamin Secret 12 is nutraceutical grade, you know, pharmacy grade vitamin B12. It's the same stuff people inject. Don't inject this. It's for under the tongue. If you want to inject it, it's even more absorbable. Go get it from a doctor. But minus that, and let me tell you, injectable from a doctor is like way up here. Our stuff's down here, but everything else is way down here. I mean, you don't absorb basically any of the synthetic trash that's out there. Put it under your tongue, hold it for a minute, and you're going to get closer to an injection. Not as good, just going to be honest with you, but it is a game changer. I sit around with top scientists, developers, chemists, and I say, what are game changers' missing links? There's a ton of them because most nutraceutical companies will put $10 into marketing, $2 into what's in it, and then sell it for $100. We don't do that. We have 100% markup on average. The average is 7 times the markup. No, I'm going to put quality in the bottle, do 100% markup, fund our operation, have all the big health sites go crazy over what we're doing, dominate the market, and have all these people buying our products that aren't even listeners now. In fact, we're getting a lot of listeners from people getting the products because they're that good. I went out and found the top 3 developers of nutraceuticals in the country, and I did deals with all 3 of them. The group's just one of them. The others are too scared to come on air from big companies, even bigger than Group. I mean, some of these companies are supplying like 1/3 of the stuff at Whole Foods, just so you know. And so that's why our stuff is so good. And plus, it's got to be bulletproof with the government coming after us, how they harass supplement makers. I want it to be great quality for everybody. I want you to come back. I want you to get a good deal. I want to be treated like I treat other people. It's like revolutionary. No, that's what built America, folks. All I'm doing is just like he did, going back and reading history books by people that actually built this country, like Booker T. Washington and others. It goes on and on and on. And the innovation of hybrid crops and modern developments came from people that were oppressed in this country, black Americans. And again, I'm not pushing oppression. The point is, open oppression makes you stronger. You should smash it. But what we're being killed by is all this largesse, how easy everything's gotten, and then not being aware. Now, I want to take phone calls, 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231, R.W. Brabe. RWBray.com. He is the Black Engagement Director of the Republican Party of Texas. He's a military veteran and a patriot, and we appreciate him being, he's currently a master sergeant serving as first sergeant guardsman and proud veterans advocate in Houston, Texas. And a lot of other community stuff for children, you name it, the MLK Association, vice chair of Texas. I'm going to stop right there. That's another thing. MLK, a Republican. It goes on and on. But give us your greatest hits. I mean, you know, what's really powerful? What folks need to know, sir, and what Trump needs to do to win? What we need to do to win?
Strategically, I think Trump needs to make sure that he has advocates and surrogates in North Carolina, Wisconsin, PA, Michigan. Reason why is because number one, that's the Rust Belt. Number two, places like Ohio, we have a significant black population who are waiting for an answer. Their neighborhoods are being torn apart by bitter rivalries, whether that's through gangs or whether that's just the simple fact that people are living in poverty, they are fed up, and they are overreacting and reacting by killing their own. That is a consequence of the Democrat lead. Think about this, Alex. 50 council members in Chicago, 49 of which are Democrat, one Republican. And you look across the nation, wherever there's Democrats in lead, in leadership, there is a failing municipality. And that's because there are some ideologies
that work. Because they're satanic.
I would agree.
Sorry.
I agree. But there are some ideologies that work, and there's some that don't. The thing about Republican ideology is that they are timeless, traditional. They've always worked. They always will, provided we remember. And the fact of the matter of fact is that humans often have a bad habit of losing memory.
I agree. Those that don't know history didn't repeat it. Please continue.
Yeah. Well, one of the ways that we're jabbing at this thing, and I gotta say this, I really love your Hillary shirt. I have a good friend of mine, Carl Maniola, came to the Trump rally with me. We almost got kicked out because they didn't read the thing. But when they finally read it.
No, it's a great conversation starter, exactly.
Yeah. They finally read it and they allowed him to come in. But I think that agitating the current status quo. Like your shirt, it agitates people. We need to continue to agitate people verbally, though, and that's the problem. There aren't enough black surrogates. If Trump wants to make a dent.
Well, exactly. In fact, that shows how sophisticated you are, because I barely even realized it when I did it. I always have the idea, and then I see the thinking behind it later. It's like my brain just knows. I wanted it to cause debates.
That's right.
And cause discussions.
That's right.
And say Hillary for prison. That's our campaign.
Yes.
And then it's really caught on. But please continue.
Well, that's what Frederick Douglass stood for. Frederick Douglass, the very first father of the civil rights movement, stood for three things. He's number one. He stood for economic independence. Number two, social and business collaboration. And number
three. Let's put Frederick Douglass on screen. That guy, he'd be a movie star today. And that guy just looks so cool. Sorry.
Yes. And number three, his last one was agitation. Agitation. One of the last things that he said in his last speech, a young black man at a university asked him, as a young black man, what should I be doing? He says, agitate, agitate, agitate. And what I see in InfoWars, what I see in people like Trump and yourself and others that I come across the nation is that we are ready. Political agitation has moved the needle.
Yeah, what you're saying is we're not trying to play in the corrupt system. We're changing it. We're not trying to play by their rules and go along with it. We're expanding the entire paradigm.
That's right. And what better place to start than Texas? The RPT is doing powerful things. We're going to areas that no other state is going. We're getting calls that no other state is calling. And when you think about that,
they rewrote Ron Paul's district over and over again. They kept rewriting it for Democrats and black areas, thinking, and then he won by even bigger landslides.
That's right.
Because people go meet him. He's just a sweet, loving doctor that had been like, you know, volunteering 3 days a week for decades.
Yes.
At poor hospitals.
That's right.
And this is a guy who literally would volunteer 2 or 3 days a week at poor hospitals.
That's right.
Because he for no money.
That's right.
Because he believed in it. And of course, he's racist Ron Paul, though.
Well, most people believe that common sense isn't common these days, but the truth is that it is. People know common sense when they see it. They see earnestness. They see a man with a correct heart. They see a person who has passion, and they will gravitate toward it. If Trump continues to make sure that he goes into these black neighborhoods, regardless of whatever the media is saying, continue to go, because I'm in those black neighborhoods.
He's been doing it.
Yeah, and they like it. They like the fact that finally someone is coming into those neighborhoods and talking, and that's how we're going to win.
Meanwhile, Obama vacations like 100 days a year and doesn't even care about Louisiana and gets away with it. I mean, I'm not defending Bush. He had some problems big time. But he some problems with Katrina response. At least he responded. They don't even show up. Hillary doesn't even care. It's like...
Well, I had a show on Lifting the Veil until the liberals got mad. It was in Houston, and they killed this show. But it was called Lifting the Veil off of Booker T. Washington. It was amazing.
Oh, local radio?
Over radio.
Oh, yeah, they kill shows.
Oh, yeah,
we get knocked off all the time. They'll come and say, $300,000, take him off.
Yeah, they're good at it. But one thing that really I touched on was that if Obama really, really cared for African-Americans, or the current administration, period, we had one opportunity to get a Supreme Court judge, and a Latino was appointed. We had another one, and the LGBT was appointed. Even his third choice that he tried to come was not a black person. So a lot of people in the black neighborhoods are starting to see that this guy never was going to make our lives better. And the truth is that you can't depend on the government to make your life better. Only you can do that.
Plus, to use the analogy, I mean, it's being pimped. I already got you. I don't need you.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, hey. Boom.
It's a given. It's about time that we start listening to our ancestors. X talked about not trusting liberals. One of the greatest quotes he ever said was, keep in mind that a Dixiecrat is nothing more than a Democrat in disguise. He talked about the fact that one party we had been invested in has abandoned us, that it was a racist from the beginning and it will always be racist. MLK warned us of not judging men by his color and not his content. You got blacks who won't join the Republican Party simply because there's a lot of white people in it.
And let's explain. It creates a self-fulfilling prophecy where they say the Tea Party's racist, and so then minorities, who are majorities in this area, don't go. And what the real racism is, the media pushing that. But then what's happening on the Trump phenomenon, I want you to speak to this because it's documented. Black Americans, Hispanic Americans, others are going, and they're absolutely being appreciated by everybody. And they're like, wow, this is incredible. And people are coming together. It's very cathartic. I've seen people crying.
That's right.
I mean, this is crazy. So again, they create the perception, which makes it the reality.
Oh, yeah. We have modern-day abolitionists right now. People who brave people of different colors going to those neighborhoods saying, come with me to this. Come with me to see Hillary's America. Come with me to watch this. And they're learning that there was a black woman who was at the Trump rally who was brought by two white friends. And she was right up front. I thought that was amazing. So there are modern-day abolitionists, but more importantly, I believe this is the rebirth of a second Reconstruction. W.E. Du Bois even said that he wished that the Reconstruction had finished its mark. It never finished what it was supposed to do. Now it has an opportunity to do that. Republicans need to wake up and know.
Well, they got hijacked by a lot of corruption when Lincoln got killed.
Well, obviously, yeah. You cut off the head of the snake, right?
Yeah. All I know is I don't know how Trump gets blamed for being in the KKK when 20 years ago and 10 years ago, he by himself, he decried David Duke. And then meanwhile, Hillary's like kissing all over Robert Byrd, the KKK wizard. I mean, it's just, you can't make this up. I mean, it's just.
No. And I think another thing is to add something to it. The black community has finally woke up to Margaret Sanger and her lies. You know, we have a population that is declining in the black neighborhood. When you consider 120 years ago, black population made up 30, we're at 12 to 13% now. So over a century and a half, we only make up 13%.
Oh, I know. That's the fundamental where I'm told you're racist because you don't want Black Lives Matter and George Soros trying to turn black people into racist. So that, in fact, there was a big study out last week. I meant to cover it. I didn't get into it. Major university study. Can you guys pull it up? Diversity programs actually make things less diverse and hurt minority communities. Absolutely.
Yes.
You turn Hispanics and black people into basically KKK versions for minority groups, mm-hmm. hopping up and down, truly real progressive business owners, I don't care what color they are, don't want trouble.
That's right.
They're just, all of a sudden, they're not racist. They're scared. And people are looking like chips. I mean, the worst thing about spoiled kids, and we've all got them, mm-hmm. Nowadays in this society, is that they always think there's a chip on their shoulder and you did something to them. Mm-hmm. And that's part of maturity is getting past having a chip on your shoulder. And they're just trying to install chips on people's shoulders.
Yes.
Like it's a degree or something.
Yes.
When all it is an anchor around your neck.
And speaking of anchors, the anchor institutions, black anchor institutions like NAACP are now fighting against charter schools and academies. P. Diddy actually just created a charter school in New York. The NAACP is going to be trying to fight to kill it. Nationwide, it is now mandated.
And good for P. Diddy.
Yeah,
like, I'm going to help people that want to get out of this hell.
Exactly. Exactly. And if they don't know how to teach our children, then why not get a retired superintendent, retired teachers in the area, and create a charter school and teach those kids in a way that the liberal whites are failing? Why is that bad? The truth is that the Democrat Party wants to corral African Americans and minorities into one area so they can control them.
Absolutely. I want to go to Tony and Carl and Mike and Alex and Dave and others. We only got 5 minutes in the next segment, and then 5 minutes more before the next hour starts. And who do we have taking over today in the fourth hour? David Knight will always be doing a great job. So much to cover. They're launching massive censorship initiatives that Drudge is covering, drudgereport.com. YouTube's new terms of service just says if you're an extremist, we're going to take your monetization away. That's economic gulags. Okay, that's what Hitler and the ghettos. I mean, this is a major move. It's the Chinese social credit model, and Drudge is covering all that, Paul Watson's article. But let's take a phone call before we go to break. Like I just can't help it. I'm going to skip this network break, even though it costs us like $5,000. I'm doing it because I need to just have more time here. So callers realize that. Let's go ahead and talk to Tony. He says he's an NBC whistleblower. I was calling for whistleblowers a few days ago, and some called in to talk about the atmosphere with this unified press environment, which Assange is just like, this is like totalitarianism. This is the unified BS. Really shameful, quite frankly, and frightening. Tony, go ahead.
Hey, thank you, Alex. Been a long listener. It's about 2009. And, back since 9/11, I started to realize that something wasn't right. So I've seen the documentary, what was it called, Loose Change, and I started to see things. And as I worked in the news, I just felt like a lot of these stories weren't given both sides. So as I became producer on a weekend newscast and the anchor, I started adding little bits to the story and giving my sources, and then we had high ratings. I mean, it was incredible to the point where they didn't know why. So the viewers started emailing in, and then they were like, he's got this information. So I get called into the office, and they say, hey, you need to stop putting this stuff into the stories because, it's not approved by NBC. And I'm like, well, we have to share both sides of the story, so I think it's good journalism. Isn't that what we studied? They're like, no, it's coming from NBC. You just put it in the way it is. Don't change it. And I said, okay. I said, but we're going to lose ratings. I mean, you need to look at that. I mean, people love this information. Look, you're just being told don't do it. All right.
So absolutely. I mean, I want to hear the rest of your story, but for folks that don't know, local so-called news, and I want to change this while we're launching a TV system. I've been so busy fighting other fights, I haven't quite got that launch yet, but it's happening, folks. And it always, you know, good times seems to be in God's plan. But everybody should just put out their own news. It's inexpensive now to do it compared to what it was, so that stations, UHF, VHF, cable, have a choice and don't just spew, because it comes down in talking points. They load the teleprompter. It looks like your local trusted news person that's more trusted than national. Let's say 50% trusted local versus 6% national. But really, your local person is really a national repeater. And so you're witnessing people want both sides, or three or four sides. They want it. It makes your ratings go up. But the media is still willing to kill itself to be able to maintain the political control, because they're not in the business of making money at the news level. They're in the business of making money for the larger global agenda and massive trillion-dollar banker bailouts. But finish the rest of the story. I apologize.
That's okay. No, and then, you know, the funny thing is I heard one of your other callers yesterday talking about, you know, you're trying to bring stories to the newsroom. You know, people just, you know, they look at you like you're crazy. Like, you know, you're one of those nuts. And I said, no, I said, look, here's information. Here's documentation. This is important stuff. So they're like, then you get labeled. So then you're kind of labeled in the newsroom and you're kind of an outcast. So they thought the best way to, you know, help me not put out the message was to put me on a morning show and make it fun. Yeah, he's got a good personality, you know.
Sir, that's a handbook. When they walked in at Shamrock Communications, I had the number one show in talk radio, period, in Austin, after 3 years on air. I'm 25 years old. I'm making them tons of money. And they said, you're going to do an entertainment show now in the morning, or we're going to fire you. And I said, I can't stop it. 6 weeks later, they fired me with pleasure. And they said, because you're talking bad about Bill Clinton. Now, I'd already started my other show, so it didn't matter. But I have experience where you're going to do entertainment now, buddy. Do you understand? Or next, you're fired. Please continue.
So then it was right around the time the NDAA was signed, and it was in the newscast, which I didn't produce. You know, I could only add the promos and the teases. And then I figured, well, since I can't really put it in the scripts, well, here's an opportunity. We're going to go to a two-shot. So I go to the two-shot and say, hey, you know, a lot of folks don't really know what that stands for, what those acronyms mean. And then I explained a little bit about it. And then she just kind of looked at me, my co-anchor, and just, I don't know, you're getting information. I'm like, well, it's out there. Here's a copy of it.
That's how brainwashed. They don't even want you to say National Defense Authorization Act. Like having info is now like evil. Oh, he's informed. You're not allowed to. NBC from New York sends it, and we just say it. He's talking on his own. We can't have that. See, it's programming, folks. Teleprompters down to us.
That's right.
And when Trump, you know, is forced to use one because it's his actual speech, that's fine. But when he's attacking it, he's saying, look, it's script written. It's coming down to them. So let me guess, what happened next?
Well, you know, I just, I was no longer in the circle, and I was kind of an outcast. And I could just feel the pressure from beneath me, because when you make your way to that position, there's everybody on the bottom just gunning it just to put you out or to get you off. So I was no longer invited to the parties, and, you know, I'd leave the newsroom and I'd come back.
First they ostracize, then they dehumanize you, because they don't want to actually fire their friend. They have to learn to hate you first, because they're cowards, number one. So how did it end?
Well, it was about a couple of months into my second year, they decided to let me go. I was kind of having some health issues, so I went to the doctor. And, you know, I almost passed out. So they were giving me checks and everything. They say, hey, look, don't go to work. And they figured, well, maybe the morning show isn't for you. It's too early. So I presented that to my bosses, and they delayed me coming back. And then before you know it, I get a letter saying I'm gone. And, you know, there's like 30 reasons why you could be let go. Like if you're a kid and you're suspended from school, you're suspended because you bit or you spit on somebody. But in this case, it was a general term for like, just general, you know, misconduct.
Got it. And then I got to jump. But thank you for your testimony. We want to get more of those testimonies. God bless you, Tony, because that's what goes on behind the scenes where they're, we had newspaper reporters on about this, and they're just like, yeah, we all get in a room and they go, we're going to lie about Trump, just make stuff up. Everybody go get him. I mean, they don't even, Assange, who's a real liberal, you know, like a really person I respect, who actually is a liberal, not a, you know, KKK person masquerading as a liberal. He's like, this press climate, we're all in danger. Hillary is a monster. I mean, it's like, it's so shameful to see this level of control. And they're only destroying themselves in the process.
Yeah, and the foundation is an example of how corruption just breeds more corruption. You would think you're the third most important person in America, and you still want to be more corrupt. You have no reason to be corrupt. But it's so much more out there to that. And I think as far as the black population and minorities, period, I think they see that. And I think that they don't want to vote for a crook, and they'll probably vote for Donald Trump.
Well, sure. And a lot of polls, he's way ahead. But those are the scientific polls, the big fake ones they put out where they had 15% more.
Come on.
Reuters admits they had 15% more Democrats at the poll, and then Hillary's winning by 15 points.
No.
I mean, you know, it's like because they put the methodology out, it's like, it's okay. Oh, we stacked the deck, but we admit we do, so it's all right.
Mm-hmm.
What?
No, it's not a true. The only way you know that the true vision is looking at it under unadulterated lenses is if you're on the ground. And I'm on the ground, brother. And I'm in the hood, no mistaking. And these individuals are walking around talking about, I'm going to vote for Trump. And it has very little to do with what it is that they can get from him. Is what it is they've been waiting for. They've been waiting for a change and a growth. They didn't get that from the previous administration. And they feel abandoned by the current administration. And so they're going to do whatever they can to
take. That's what I'm seeing on the streets. I mean, I would say half the black people I talk to say they like Trump, but they're almost embarrassed. Like, well, Alex, I can tell you, but you know, my neighbors don't like it. And so yes. I think if people just get past this fear and come out of the closet.
That's right. That's right. And I talked about that, you know, in the speech. And I'm hoping that Donald Trump will bring more black surrogates at these rallies so that you can dispel the myth that blacks aren't coming out. And I'm not talking about entertainment, you know, Alex. I'm talking about giving a real speech to people. And that's what the kind of surrogate he needs out there right now.
Absolutely. He needs to absolutely hammer the daylights out of the globalists. The problem is a lot of times he does, the media just doesn't cover it.
Yeah.
So we have to get the videos. We have to get the raw
that's
stuff.
Right.
We have to put it out like InfoWars.com and PrisonPlanet.com and DrudgeReport.com are doing. And that's why they say they want to censor Trump. You know, I mean, they have these fake debate coming up where he's back to back with Hillary, but then he doesn't get to ask her questions. That's not a debate.
No. She's been quiet, what, over 260 days now?
Listen, I really believe she's got serious health problems. And the word is brain tumor. The brain tumor was removed back in 2012, and then it's growing back. So that's why she is not looking too hot. That's the word, brain tumor. We'll be back.
You are listening to GCN. Visit GCNlive.com today.
Hope she gets right with Jesus. The answer is InfoWars. The answer is reclaiming our basic roots and what works for a civilization. Responsibility, discipline, pride, honor, strength, courage. And people are desperate for it like a man underwater wants oxygen. I'm desperate for it. The New World Order wants to make us weak so they can rule us. I say folks that act like that are the ones that are weak. We're going to go to some more of your phone calls here. I am really honored to have R.W. Bray, rwbray.com. He's the Black Engagement Director of the Republican Party of Texas, and it is exciting to see the Patriot Liberty Movement taking over the Republican Party because it's got its own share of problems. But this revolution of Trump taking the party over, they may try to take it back, but they are you know what, in their britches.
Yes. I'm happy for the RPT, Republican Party of Texas, finally growing up. We're doing things that no other state is doing, and I love the fact that it's coming out of Texas. I really do.
I'm proud of Texas. Texas always has that cliche, and growing up, you rebel against whatever you've been told is great. But I mean, now that I've grown up and know my parents and grandparents, and Texas isn't perfect, but compared to a lot of other places in the world, whatever, it is true, like, original Texans I knew were just, no matter what color they were just honorable, straight shooting.
That's right.
And tough.
That's right.
Texas is at the head of the resistance. That's what Obama calls me, the man from Texas. And I love the fact he won't say my name. He goes, you know, that's out of Texas. And the media's like, oh. It's almost better. It's like the name they won't say. Actually, I can feel the eye of Sauron looking at me, though. This is quite a responsibility. These people are bad news. That's why I joke about it. Let's go ahead and talk to Mike in Minnesota. You're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex, thanks for having me on the show. I literally just started listening, love it. But commenting on the whole charter schools and diversity that you guys spoke about earlier, I went to one of the largest high schools in Minnesota and most publicly funded, and we had diversity programs everywhere. And as we got older into school, the more divided it came. We had groups where...
It's meant to do it. They go, they're failing in all the university studies. It's getting worse. It's designed to make us all racist, crazy people. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, and it would be divided up so that the Somalian refugees would be on the east end, the African Americans would be on the west. Nobody really came together, and we were in elementary school.
Wow.
That's how you run a prison. It's prison group management. They're just putting us all in groups.
Yeah, definitely. No question.
And the teachers thereby don't want to do it. They're like, why is this so horrible? Because it's designed to be.
That is a sad reality. You know, I had a conversation with Tom Meckler, who's the chairman of the RPT, and we talked about how the answer to compete with these failing ISDs and this, like you said, the separation is to make sure you have charter schools and academies to challenge it. I can't remember any institution that deserves a monopoly over education. And then the way they do it is that they corral people.
Absolutely.
Sure the blacks are here, the Latinos are here, the whites are here. That doesn't encourage anyone to work together.
And then they act like it's desegregation when all they do is throw people together and then divide them even worse.
Yes.
I mean, they know, and this is some slick stuff.
Yeah, it's strategic. Alex, it's sad.
But the great part is, it's like those hidden pictures they hang on the wall. When you don't see it, you feel dumb. But as soon as you see it, it's like, oh, why didn't I see that before?
I believe that. I tell you who does see it. The Democrat Party know exactly what they're doing, and they've mastered it. And until we wake up and we have advocates who get out there and talk about it, they'll continue to throw the wool over our eyes.
Mike, did anybody else figure out what was going on when you were in Minnesota?
Well, Alex, funny story is one of our history teachers, I mean, as we got older, I probably learned the most amount of facts when I was in elementary school in terms of history, and it just turned into more social arguments as we got into high school. I graduated from high school 5 years ago, and one of our teachers actually said that he couldn't wait for the baby boomer generation to die off, that were Republicans, because then the real issues would be addressed.
Exactly. Like we get somewhere once you die, which is total totalitarianism.
Yeah.
They don't know that the next crop of folks will be taught, get rid of these people, you get something. It's like Bill Gates, if we don't give an old lady treatment, we can hire 10 teachers. The teachers are like, people die and I get things? No, you build an economy, you take care of old people, and that builds an economy. You get the service and quality you demand. It's called civilization. I'm really impressed with the work you're doing.
Thank you so much.
God bless you, sir. Folks, you can go to the website. It's rwmurray.com. David Knight's coming up. I'm going to introduce him. Stay with us.
What we are drawing attention to is the amazing transformation of Hillary Clinton and the Democratic Party into being the National Security Party and the National Security Candidate by whipping up a neo-McCarthyist hysteria about Russia. Any serious analyst understands that China and the United States are the only real games in town. China has 10 times the population of Russia, 7 times the GDP. Russia has the GDP of Italy. It's interesting in that it wants to be, you know, that it makes provocative statements and so on. It's interesting. And, of course, within its own neck of the woods, countries in between Russia and China, Caucasus and so on, Russia is very significant to them. But on the world stage, Russia is a big player. Now, that attempted reframing by Hillary Clinton to declare media organizations that are publishing material that shows illicit behavior in the DNC to fix the election for her as somehow us being Russian agents, similar criticism has emerged from people connected to her campaign to The Intercept, where Glenn Greenwald works. Her campaign has effectively called, and maybe even directly called, Donald Trump, the opposition leader in this case, a Russian agent. Jill Stein, the Greens Party candidate, effectively the fourth candidate in terms of numbers, being called a Russian agent. This is a neo-McCarthyist hysteria. What kind of press environment is this going to lead to post-election? The American press, in the American liberal press, in falling over themselves to defend Hillary Clinton, are erecting a demon that is going to put nooses around everyone's necks as soon as she wins the election, which he is almost certainly going to do.
That is part of the, and I don't overuse the term epic. It so much stuff is epic now because there's a quickening happening. And the whole interview is on InfoWars.com right now. Everybody needs to spread this interview to the four corners of the planet. I mean that figuratively before the New York Times says that I believe the Earth is flat or four-cornered. You have Trump going to Mexico and saying globalism is screwing both our countries. Carlos Slim, by the way, isn't even a Mexican. You can't make this stuff up. And they are screwing everyone over. Let's come together. And the Mexican president comes out and says, I like Trump. And the Trump says they hit it off. And you can see the body language when they're out there on stage together. Because they misrepresent everything Trump says. Trump's like, you grab people that come in from Guatemala, you can't have your border open and get people free stuff. The Mexicans are like, oh, yeah, that's true. I don't dislike you. I mean, we got to have doors on our houses, people. And I'll be quite frank with you. And Trump's talked about this too. I don't care if you're Hispanic, black, white, or whoever you are. Americans have killed our children. Well, the credit to Hispanics, they haven't done as much. So Hispanics deserve to take over the United States. I mean, you know, quite frankly, it's the Darwin Award. You kill your kids, you deserve to not be around anymore. Fine, repopulate the United States with Mexicans. The point is that they're politically bringing them in and brainwashing them to carry out the New World Order. It must be stopped. The brainwashing, the anchor babies, the free crap. It's not fair. It's not right. The Ford Foundation instilling all this race baiting. Why would the Ford Foundation give $100 million to BLM? Because they're going to create basket cases where everyone has chips on their shoulders and never overcomes and gets stronger. That's how you become a force. No, you just get a chip, and your whole job in the world is having a chip on your shoulder. It's the essence of immaturity. I mean, I used to wonder why I was working on ranches and stuff. The cowboys would be mean to me and stuff at first. They were just testing to see who I was. And then by the end of the summer, they were like tears in their eyes. I was leaving. And I never sit there, people in my life, and mess with them up front. I guess I do now. I need to mess with people when they're first in my life or have a job or whatever, just to see who you are. Let's mess with you. Let's find out what's really going on under here. But as you get older, you learn this stuff, and then you look at what the media is doing, and you're like, oh, my God, these are some nasty people. Now, I want to turn the baton over to David Knight, who, by the way, is always a handsome guy. But he looks like the most interesting man right now. I'm ready for a Dos Equis commercial. I think, David, we found your look with that gray suit and black shirt. You look pretty sharp, Alex. Over there.
Thanks, Alex. Yeah, I'm going to talk about what I call Trump's Mexican summit, Alex. It's pretty amazing because even his hardcore critics, NPR, The Washington Post, even Bill Kristol are talking about how he really had a huge win yesterday.
It was a grand slam.
That's absolutely amazing. Yeah. And, you know, of course, also we look at what's going on with SpaceX. I think there's a lot of metaphors to be seen here. But one of the things I wanted to talk about was what you were just talking about with Julian Assange. He said what the New York Times is selling is conspiracy and not journalism. That's absolutely true. There's not an ounce of real facts in this. And yet this conspiracy that the Russians are behind everything that happens bad to the Democrats, that's being used in some very serious ways as we look at Homeland Security. I thought it was very interesting in that article that you had, the interview that you had earlier today, when we were talking to Scott Adams. And at the very end of the interview, you pointed out to him, you know, Homeland Security is angling to take over our elections. And he goes, no, that can't be true. I mean, it's just so far out that people can't accept
it. And listen, I'm even conditioned with normalcy bias.
Yeah.
I should have been talking all day. In fact, I thought of this earlier and didn't get back to it. I should have been talking all day, productions, showing it. I had this whole plan to get clips of Obama denying it and saying, and then now they admit it and showing how mainstream news clips admitting that Goldman Sachs is installing presidents in Europe and explain. Davos is calling for the end of elected governments.
Yes.
I mean, it's like, do you understand, folks? Hillary's putting out fundraising letters saying shut down the alt-right. And then she comes out and names yours truly. I mean, this is it, people. It's real. It hit me like a ton of bricks this morning, and I was absolutely upset. I never almost get hysterical. I was just, like, really concerned. I was like, what is it? What is it? I went, oh, my God. It was all the news I read early that morning before I exercised. There's a demarcation line in the last few days. You could say it started September 1st, 2016, we're in the New World Order. It's on. Everything is moving at, let me get this exactly right. Their takeover is now moving at 20 times the previous speed, and I mean that number. I've really thought about that. Before, it was all incremental testing. It's now boom. I mean, it is boom. We are in it now, David.
You know, Alex, they always say, how does a very rich person go bankrupt? They asked a rich person once, and he said, well, gradually at first and then very rapidly. And that's what we're seeing happening here. They've got this deadline. They've been talking about massive structural reorganization of the global governance.
I totally forgot. You're right. Germany admits they're on the verge of collapse. Exactly. Yeah. And the average person, it's too scary. Oh, they're not taking over the elections. Oh, Germany's not saying get emergency supplies, prepare for a massive emergency. And I'm so conditioned. I've been saying it for so long. I'm not even up here tooting our horn, David.
Yeah.
In fact, I've got the articles right here. Deutsche Bank refuses clients' demand for physical gold. And it goes on and on and on, and they admit that they're telling... David, you covered it last Friday. What do you think the Germans... The national government says get ready for a serious emergency, get food and water, and the Germans clean the shelves off. What is going on there?
Oh, they're doing a lot of prepping, and I think the key thing is there's a massive run on home safes because they can't trust the banks. You've got this negative interest rate that's going on. They know that they could confiscate their money and call it a haircut. They don't even want to put their money in safe deposit boxes because they know they'll steal that. So you've got this massive movement, a shortage of safes because everybody wants to take their cash home, put it there. Why not? Why should they have to pay the banks to save their money? Instead of the banks paying them any interest, they have to pay the banks and then have it subject to confiscation or just outright theft, if you want to call it.
And by the way, U.S. banks, you know, in the new stress test reports, I didn't even cover this. I read this like a month ago. I think it was Market Watch, and I didn't even cover it because I've been so close to it for so long. I don't want to just say, we told you. So I stuck it in the stack, David. We should pull it up. It was some kind of headline like, let me go to memory here. Let me see if I can still do this exact memory. U.S. banks in next crisis might need U.S. Greece-style bail-in. And then it went on to say they're preparing and looking at taking money out of your account or negative interest rates where you pay them to have an account or pay them to have money. I mean, it's like they're actually in major publications now lubing us up for grabbing the money out of our accounts, David.
Well, you know, that was one of the key things, I think, from Nigel Farage, I remembered, was the time that he got up at the EU, and he said, who are you to shut down the democratically elected leaders of Italy and Greece and put in these Goldman Sachs bankers? Who are you to override that?
But Let's say it again.
Yeah.
Appointing presidents and prime ministers, and then having Soros get up and brag about it at Davos with his little demon egghead. Yeah. And it's like, what the... You got an arch criminal, war criminal, overthrowing all these countries, running around and appointing leaders of countries?
Well, Alex, you know, that story that was on Drudge a couple of days ago, is Breitbart's story with Bill Clinton. They went back, they looked at the Clinton Global Initiative, where he was talking to the yogurt billionaire, Chobani Yogurt. And they were talking about how they could bring in these Syrian refugees, how they were the greatest people, the greatest workers and entrepreneurs in the world. They could bring them in. There's 10,000 empty homes in Detroit. And, you know, Hillary Clinton's policy will bring in more people in her first term than the entire population of Detroit.
Yeah, they're saying Americans don't matter. We're going to resettle you and then give them welfare money.
That's right.
Like crops of things that are growing. Sorry, go ahead.
And it's even worse, Alex, because I covered that on Tuesday's Nightly News with Leanne McAdoo, the fact that this guy, who is this Chobani Yogurt guy? Well, he's a Turkish citizen who is sitting on the board of the New York Fed, setting our monetary policy. He's not even an American citizen. And furthermore, he's sitting there with Bill Clinton and the Clinton Global Initiative and talking about how they're going to establish immigration policy. He's not even an American citizen. And he's using these people as slaves when they come into his factory.
And they're going to have basically the UN, EU oversee our election and have Homeland Security run it. But Donald Trump's wrong that they're going to have feds involved. And I'm wrong.
Yeah.
The creature in Texas is wrong. I'm sorry. Dare not say her name. Now, I'm going to hand the baton to you in a moment. I have a lot to cover here, David. But let me just add this. Something, I didn't drop the ball today, but it's epic level. Again, I use that word. It is big. It's biggest. They're announcing YouTube, Google, that if the politically correct moderators that ban people for no reason, if they don't like what you're doing, they demonetize you, basically steal your money. That is the Chinese model, and DrudgeReport.com
That's right.
He's linked to our article on it, where they say you're going to have a social credit rating that the state and the telecoms and the big internet companies decide, down to the point of not being able to buy or sell online, and then finally not even having a job. This is the communist Chinese model to control their 1,300,000,000 people. And you've been to China, your adopted daughter from China, you've seen the slavery. I mean, you described it to me, the hellish orphanages. Imagine this is how they control these poor people. And now they're bringing it here. I mean, this is so draconian, so flamingly evil. But it's just a terms of service agreement. Like, oh, Samsung, we're watching you off the camera at home. Behave yourself. And they're like, oh, okay, they're watching me. Big deal. I mean, it's just, and imagine, David, it's going to get crazier and crazier and crazier. And I'm going to say this, then I'm done. Listen to me carefully, folks. This signifies how desperate they are that they're accelerating their plan, which is way behind schedule, because they know people now understand globalism and the system, and they get the con, and it's exponentially growing. And so when you see all this draconian action, understand it's scary, it's serious, we got to fight it, but it's a sign of their weakness. They are showing themselves, they are moving quickly. China's never had freedom. They're great, smart people, but they never had a Magna Carta, never had a 1776. Doesn't mean we're perfect, but we just got a few steps ahead of them. If the Chinese ever had true free market, they will take over the planet, and that's fine with me. The point is that the globalists don't want them to have that, and they treat them like trash, and they are totally abused, and it is so sad, and it is so out of control, and we have to understand that we are in the crucible right now. We are in the arena. This is history happening right now, and I can tell you what Donald Trump talk to the Mexican president about. The president may get pressured. He may say some bad things later, but he said some nice things so far. So has Trump said. They really hit it off. And I know what Donald Trump said to him. Not because I talked to Donald Trump, but you watch. It might be 6 months, might be a year, might be tomorrow. It's going to come out. I said he should say, we're both being oppressed by globalism. Let's come together. Because I know Trump's so informed and has generals advising him. So I'm just going to stop right there. I know the type of advice he's getting. I know the intel he's getting. That's why I know what he said. I know he leaned across and said, you want to free your people and actually let your country shine with their great ingenuity and all their hard work and smarts and innovation? You know they're laundering the drug money. You know the big banks run your country. You know you've sold your people out for generations. This can all change. I'm ready to break the will of the New World Order, and we can have real prosperity. It's going to be hard. But if you want the civil war that was started, run by Washington folks, you can bet you're the globalist. I guarantee you Trump told him, I'm ready to stop the oppression of Mexico. Because I looked at that president closely on the close-up videos. He had tears in his eyes during part of it because no president or person about to be president would ever actually come and talk to him.
Yeah.
Trump completely blew the blinders off that guy. He was like a deer in the headlights, folks, because Trump is like Alex Jones. Imagine if I met with the Mexican president and I was about to be president, what I would say. It'd be that. I can guarantee you. That's what Trump said. Just as I said what Trump should say yesterday. He didn't hear that from me. He was on an airplane flying to Mexico then. The thing is, Trump doesn't listen to me. The reason I've talked to Trump and he clicks is it's like finishing each other's sentences. I'm going to stop right there because they make news stories out of it. The point is, Trump is so dialed in, it is crazy, okay? Heaven sent, okay? Now, I that's all I'm telling you. I want to play one little clip to have some fun and then hand the baton to David Knight. People tell me take more time off. I need to. So we went out on some friend's boat, and Tim Kennedy, soldier, and some of the other soldiers, interesting fellows, went out there with us. My security detail went out there with us. It's ridiculous. And we're there, and they're like tackling each other and fighting, all this other stuff. And I said, oh, yeah? And I didn't have to tell. That's what's great about single folks. Tell Tim, hey, tackle me. I was like, you know, I actually support Hillary Clinton. I really like her now. And he tackled me. And again, that's what syncing up is about. It's not that you're on the same page. And that's what society's supposed to be like, folks. Honor and common sense, you sync. And the globalists are desyncing us. Freedom is about syncing. It doesn't mean being on the same piece of paper. It means being in reality, and then it's a clear path. So it's a funny little clip, but it's funny to know it wasn't scripted. It's like, I knew he would do it. I said it. It happened. And again, that's a little microcosm of what the media is trying to figure out with this Trump stuff and me. Look, Trump and I are tuned into the same spirit. You understand the same animating? It's folks, it is metaphysical. It's incredible. And it's happening. And I'm just going to leave it right there. Okay? But This is what's happening. It's biblical, ladies and gentlemen. Here's the clip.
I like Hillary Clinton. You know, that's where I support. So, Tim Kennedy, I'm a support Hillary right now.
No! Ah! And again, that's just a microcosm of not scripting something, but it was scripted because he got exactly what I was saying. We were synced. David Knight, take over. Thanks for letting me take over 25 minutes of the show. We love you. Please continue.
Oh, thank you, Alex. You know, one of the things that's very dangerous, we're going to talk about what Julian Assange has said about Hillary's Un-American Activities Commission, because that's basically what it is. Remember when we had the McCarthyism? We had the House Un-American Activities Committee. HUAC, you know, we don't even need to change the acronym. You know, we should just stay with HUAC and just substitute for House Hillary, because whenever anything happens to them, it's always, you're with the Russians. It's actually pretty funny when you look at it. But when we look at what's going on with Homeland Security, and I think we need to really delve into this and look at this carefully and think about what's going to happen with this. You know, we've got Jay Johnson, who is whining about the fact that we've got 9,000 different jurisdictions running elections all over this country. That's a good thing, but it's not if you want centralized control. You have to understand, these people want a command-control economy. They want central control of everything because they are authoritarians. And think about what is going to happen if we centralize control of our elections. It means that they're going to also standardize it. How are they going to standardize it? They're going to standardize it by making it more electronic. That is the key vulnerability. So here are these people where everything is being hacked. The DNC is being hacked. Hillary is being hacked. You've got personnel files from the federal government that have been hacked in a massive way. Even the NSA has been hacked. Their hacking code was hacked. Okay. That's a recursive hack, I guess. They hacked their hacking code and put it on the internet for sale. Okay. So what would you want to do? I think you would want to not go into that environment until you've at least demonstrated that you have got some control over it, don't you? But instead, what they want to do is to standardize that. And that's really what's going to happen. They're going to make our election system even more vulnerable because they want to control it. Understand that the forefront of electronic elections has been Hugo Chavez's Venezuela. Smartmatic, the largest seller of electronic voting machines, was created by Hugo Chavez cronies in Venezuela to control the elections there. And as we talked about last night, they have a string of corruption throughout Central and South America, including the Philippines. They go in, they run these elections. All of a sudden, guess what? The system went down and we lost 25% of the votes. We don't have any audit trail for any of this stuff. But trust us, we know how they voted. We're going to tell you how 25% of the people voted, but there's no audit trail for this. This is the kind of corruption that we're looking at here. And this is something that happened 2 years ago in Brazil. People there accused a very unpopular socialist who was found guilty of all kinds of corruption, money laundering, campaign violation, campaign contribution violation. Sounds very much like Hillary Clinton, doesn't it? She was running for reelection. All this stuff was happening. The economy was failing. Inflation was going up. And there were massive corruption scandals and looting of a oil company that they had taken government control of. As all this was happening, she was down anywhere from 6.5 to 10 points in the polls just before the election. And then miraculously, she wins, even though she was just prior to it, she was booed by a stadium of 60,000 fans. She wins. That's the danger of electronic elections. We can make it safe. We can make it very simple. We know how to do it. Use paper, use human observers, vote on the same day, use photo IDs, but they don't want that. They want it complex so they can rig it. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this this Thursday, September 1st, 2016. You know, it's been 272 days since Hillary Clinton has done a press conference. I think that's a big reason why she didn't go down and talk to the Mexican president, because she couldn't handle a press conference afterwards. But the press seems to be letting her get away with that. And we're going to get back to the news here. And I want to talk about SpaceX, because I think it tells us a great deal about Hillary Clinton. I think it even tells us something about 9-11 and also Julian Assange, what he's talking about with the New York Times, I think tells us, gives us some insights about 9-11. We've had WND put out a story today talking about 9-11. So welcome, WND. I'm glad they're talking about that. They've talked about it before in the past. They took it on directly this time. So we're going to talk about that story as well coming up. Before we do, real quickly, we have 20% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink at InfoWarsLife.com, a great way to support your health and to support our operation here. It's the affordable, great-tasting Vitamin Mineral Fusion Drink. It is a game-changing formula that helps you get a full month's supply of essential vitamins, minerals, and amino acids that your body needs in a very tasteful, easy to assimilate, easy to take format. That is just mixing that in with water or with carbonated water, which is what I did this morning with mine. Tasted great. My wife did that for me. Again, you can get that now 20% off at InfoWarsLife.com. That's your baseline multivitamin support right there in a drink mix. Also, we still have the Blackheart special at InfoWarsStore.com. That's the Hillary for Prison t-shirt at cost. $9.95. We've had so many people saying, hey, we want to help InfoWars. Alex has put a second link there. If you want to buy it at full price to help the organization, you can pay $20 for it, or you can get it at cost, $9.95. Either way, we want you to get that information out there. If you want to help support the operation, that we would be really appreciate that, but we'll offer it to you for cost because we are serious about Hillary Clinton needing to go to prison, not to the White House. Now, let's talk about what happened today with SpaceX. We had a rocket that was going to take up Facebook's newest internet satellite. It was a $200 million satellite. I mean, that's a lot of money, but think about it this way. If you're a Facebook executive, I want to talk to Mark Zuckerberg now and tell Mark it's not all that bad. That's less than half of what Obama sent in a pallet's load of cash to the Iranians, okay? He sent them $450 million. So this is only $200 million, Mark, and I'm sure that Obama can make it up to you because you guys are really good friends. Maybe, you know, he can find some more cash in a Swiss bank that he can put on a pallet and send to you to kind of cover those costs there if you're not insured. So $200 million, but it's less than Obama sent to Iran, okay, and burned on that particular mission. A series of explosions sent smoke and flames shooting through the sky and shook buildings miles away. You know, when I saw that, I thought about what Hillary Clinton said earlier this week when she was talking about all of her corruption, her privileged immunity, you know, acting as if, I guess she's got diplomatic immunity because she was Secretary of State. She can't be prosecuted no matter what she does. Or maybe that immunity comes from being a Clinton. I don't know. Or just the people that she knows or what she knows about people. Maybe that's it. Maybe it's what Hillary knows about people. But when I looked at that and I thought about it, shocking buildings miles away, you know, I thought about how her corruption has sent shockwaves through our political system and how it is destroying our political system. But also her remarks. Remember earlier this week, she said, you know, these emails, there's lots of smoke, but there's no fire. Now, look at this picture. I tweeted this out earlier today. I tweeted out the picture. One of the pictures is up there. Yeah, there's a lot of smoke there. But you can also see there's fire because, you know, that's the metaphor, actually, Hillary. That's the true metaphor. You're trying to sell us a phony metaphor. Where there is smoke, there is fire. You can see that fire on the launching pad as the Facebook satellite and the rocket that it's on blow up, explode, and catch fire, okay? But now, as I put out, as I tweeted out, you know, Hillary said, well, there's lots of smoke but no fire. She looks at that. Brazil, Donna Brazile of the Democrat National Committee, she's now taken the place of Hillary's other friend, Debbie Wasserman Schultz. She says, no, I don't see any smoke. Because that's what she said earlier this week when she was on the talk shows and they were asking her about it. Even as they go, and I put that hashtag bleach bit there because, you know, even as they're talking about the industrial software that she put in there, which doesn't just delete a file, but it overwrites your disk so that you can't recover the information. You know, the information is there. You can always reverse engineer that with some recovery software. They go back, they lose the directory, but they can, as long as the information is still on the disk, they can rebuild that, especially with a text file. So they use something like BleachBit to actually overwrite the data on the disk so that it's not recoverable. The only good thing about this, I guess, is that the people in Africa have now been granted a reprieve from being dominated by Facebook, a temporary reprieve at least. They're going to keep going with that. But let's talk about what Alex Jones brought up earlier, talking about Julian Assange. There's a New York Times article that came out that is accusing WikiLeaks of being affiliated with Russian intelligence. And again, as we were saying, it is the charge that they're leveling at everybody. Anybody that is an enemy of theirs is part of Russian intelligence. And he had this to say This is the RT story. It says WikiLeaks has dismissed a wordy article by the New York Times suggesting that leaks by founder Julian Assange may have benefited Moscow or come from, quote, Russian intelligence, unquote. They said the claims are false and that they impute conspiracy. Now, this was done today. This article came out today. They claim, quote, the agendas of WikiLeaks and the Kremlin have often dovetailed. They also said the majority of Julian Assange's revelations had an anti-American, slightly pro-Russia bias. Without citing a reliable proof, the newspaper went on to speculate that Assange could have received Democrat Party documents leaked earlier this year from Russian intelligence. Now, WikiLeaks replied and said the only hard news in this New York Times article is that, quote, American officials say Mr. Assange and WikiLeaks probably had no direct ties to Russian intelligence services, unquote. And he points out that was said by James Clapper, head of U.S. intelligence. He stated the U.S. government has not been able to make any attribution. We've also had the former head of technical intelligence at the NSA, William Binney, come on our show and tell us that not only does he believe that the NSA has the information if they want to get it that they can put out there, but he says he has a reason to believe that there's a lot of people that work within the NSA that would be so angry at what Hillary Clinton would do that they and get away with it, putting their lives in danger. Many people have lost their lives. Actually, Judge Napolitano said that as well. He said there's people in the intelligence community who have lost their lives over Hillary Clinton's leaks. And they're very concerned about what's going to happen with a president, Hillary Clinton. All of their heads are basically in the chopping block, in the guillotine, if Hillary Clinton becomes president. So they're angry about what's happened. They're angry about how she has exposed people, how many of them believe she has already cost people their lives. And this is not, we're not talking about Arkansas here. We're talking about costing people their lives because you've leaked intelligence that exposes them in the field. And these 30 emails that they just found that they've just turned up again. This is, you know, she used to say that Bill had these bimbo eruptions. And these people were not bimbos, okay? There were some bimbos, and that's what they wanted to focus on. That's what Ken Starr wanted to focus on. Ken Starr wanted to focus on the bimbos, not the people who were raped, who were sexually abused by Bill Clinton, okay? He wanted to focus on the people that were having consensual sex with Bill Clinton, and that's the way they excused him. He turned that attention over there. And we've seen, after Ken Starr left as quote-unquote special prosecutor to Bill Clinton, what did he do? He wound up becoming a defender of Epstein, Jeffrey Epstein, the serial pedophile who was a friend of Bill Clinton. Ken Starr defended that man in court. And then Ken Starr at Baylor, no longer at Baylor, defended football players who were accused of rape. But what he did with Bill Clinton to defend him was basically to deflect attention to bimbos, not to victims. Okay, but Hillary Clinton has got her own eruptions, this continual trickle of things that are being released, emails that are showing what they have done secretly, how they have set up pay for play, how they have played fast and loose and carelessly with national security issues. But then they go on in this article, they say, this is from WikiLeaks, a tweet from them, they say, no, Julian Assange did not say that Clinton is a demon. Actually, that would be us. Let's get the attribution right. he says the demon is neo-McCarthyist hysteria that has been erected by the liberal press. Now, we did say she's a demon, and we will gladly accept that because we really do believe that she is. And then they went on to say this. Last thing I'll have to say about this. A WikiLeaks statement rejected the notion that WikiLeaks is a sympathizer to Moscow. They said WikiLeaks has published more than 650,000 documents about Russia and about President Putin, most of which are critical. So the point of WikiLeaks is to expose secret hidden agendas, because secret hidden agendas create corruption. They give people who are prone to be corrupted by power, and everybody is prone to be corrupted by power, but the worst people seem to be able to actually achieve their goal of getting the power. But it's that corruption that comes with power that gets, it's like pouring gasoline on the fire when there is no transparency, where there is no oversight. And so the mission of WikiLeaks has been to expose this, to make people who hate transparency, people like Barack Obama, people like George W. Bush, people especially like Hillary Clinton, to expose what they are doing in the dark, to shine light on it. She talks about the dark corners of the internet. No, she is doing the things in the dark. The internet is the light that is shining on what Hillary Clinton is doing. And then as we talk about this conspiracy, you know, whether it is a conspiracy. Now we have the New York Times openly engaging in conspiracy theories. And then I thought it was interesting to see this article today appear on WorldNet Daily, WND, talking about the government's other conspiracy theory, you know, the official 9/11 story, you know, the idea that two planes caused three buildings to collapse in their footprint. Okay, just think about that for a moment. And along those lines, along the physical lines of that, of course, there's a lot of different angles we can look at this and say, you know what, the government's official conspiracy theory about 9/11 cannot be true. Again, going back to Arthur Conan Doyle's Sherlock Holmes, he says, when you eliminate the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, is the truth. Okay, so when you eliminate things that cannot happen, like these three skyscrapers falling into their footprint when only two of them were even hit by a plane, that's when we start to look at some things that might be true. Now, why did they bring this up again? We've just had another physics magazine. This is Europhysics Magazine. A respected publication of the European physics community has published a report by four experts who say the evidence points overwhelmingly to the conclusion that all three buildings were destroyed by controlled demolition. And that has far-reaching political implications, because you'd have to prepare that in advance if you're going to have a demolition, just like you have to prepare the solution. You know, when you say that we've got evidence, and the FBI comes out and says, we've got some evidence that a couple of states had some Russians snooping around in their election system, so I think we need to take it over. They are giving you a load of baloney just so they can sell you the solution that they already wanted to do, which is a government takeover. That's always what they want to sell. They say, given the far-reaching implications, it is morally imperative that this hypothesis be the subject of a truly scientific, impartial investigation by responsible authorities, said the four physicists. And then they point out in this article from WND that in August 2002, the U.S. National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST, and we've talked about this before as well, even NIST found that the three buildings were the only known cases of total structural collapse in high-rise buildings where fires played a significant role. Quote from NIST, the government's own scientific standards and technology organization, they say it bears repeating that fires have never caused the total collapse of a steel-framed high-rise before or since 9/11. Okay, did we witness an unprecedented event three separate times on September 11th? Yeah. Again, two planes, three buildings. Do the math, okay? And then they go on to talk about some of the other aspects of it. And I have to ask, you know, where are the lawsuits? We just had a lawsuit that was shut down out in Colorado. You know, every time there's a shooting, they try to come after the place where the shooting occurred, the movie theater in Aurora, Colorado, or they go after gun manufacturers, even though there are laws that say you can't sue a gun manufacturer just because they make guns. That doesn't make it give them any liability, any criminal liability in that crime. Just like you can't sue Ford if you've got a jihadi using a Ford truck to run down people at a French beach, okay? The people who made that truck didn't do anything wrong. It was a person who was running people down that did something wrong. But where are the people suing the engineers and architects that built the World Trade Center? Why aren't they suing the building inspectors there in New York City who inspected that, who went over their design, who double-checked that? Why aren't they suing the people who built it? Interesting, isn't it? Now, I want to abruptly change this. I got a story just as we went to break that Kit Daniels gave to me. This is something we've talked about before. Gary Johnson loves to say that he's not against the Second Amendment, even though he chose William Weld, who is against the Second Amendment, and said, you know, I'm not going to run as a Libertarian candidate if I don't get William Weld as my VP. He was very adamant about that. And there was a lot of debate at the time within the party. So this guy has been against the Second Amendment from the get-go. And now the NRA is pointing that out. This is a story by Kit Daniels at Infowars.com. The Libertarian Party is running an anti-gun candidate for vice president, warns the NRA. They say, as governor of Massachusetts, William Wells supported various gun control schemes, including a ban on semi-automatic firearms. The NRA also says, unfortunately, and despite being the Libertarian candidate for vice president, Weld continues his anti-gun ways. Weld recently confirmed his anti-gun stance and his ignorance on guns in general, writes Kit. He says, and this is a quote from William Weld in an interview just recently in August. The five-shot rifle, says Weld, that's a standard military rifle. The problem is, if you attach a clip to it so it can fire more shells, and if you remove the pins, it becomes an automatic weapon. And those are independent criminal offenses. That's when it becomes essentially a weapon of mass destruction. And he also attacked AR-15s. Well, let me tell you something, Weld. You should take a look at the flag that we have all over here in Texas, the come and take it flag. You know what's on that flag? It's not a musket. It's a cannon. It's a cannon. You know, when they went to get the arms at Concord and Lexington in Massachusetts, where you were governor, they went there to take the cannons, not just the firearms. The Second Amendment is about the militia protecting our country, not a standing army. They were supposed to be military weapons to protect us from foreign and domestic enemies. Stay with us. We'll be right back. All right, welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. We're going to talk about Donald Trump's Mexican summit, because I think that's really what we ought to talk about. It's so much of a victory. We've got an article here from The Hill saying Trump has the ball and Hillary can't run out the clock. We're going to take a look at what Donald Trump's critics said about what happened yesterday. But before we do, real quickly, just want to let you know that our initial supply of BioTrue Selenium is running low. You'll find that at InfoWarsLife.com. Again, this is our initial run of a new Selenium that we are selling at InfoWarsLife.com. This is from a 100% organic source. It's 100% organic mustard seed. They press it out of that. So you not only do you not get some trace heavy metals that you might get in some mineral formulations of selenium, it's not synthetic. It is organic, and it doesn't have any of these heavy metals. As a matter of fact, when they press it out of the organic mustard seed, you actually get some good things out of that as well. But again, it's something that is very important for your health, and it's a new formulation that we have at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, we have 20% off vitamin mineral fusion drink mix. That's at InfoWarsLife.com while supplies last. So take advantage of that. And the Hillary for Prison t-shirt, part of our Black Heart special, you can get that at cost at InfoWarsStore.com, $9.95. That's our cost. If you want to help our organization, we have another little box down there that Alex has added, so you can pay full cost if you would like to help us to support our operation here, but we're going to put that out there at cost for people because we want to get that message out. Again, your Hillary for Prison t-shirt at cost, part of our Black Heart special at InfoWarsStore.com. Let's talk real quickly in the time we got left about Trump's Mexican summit. This is the Washington Post. No friend to Donald Trump. They say Donald Trump went to Mexico and won. Okay? Hillary was the loser in this, folks. That's not their subtitle. But they say after weeks of scrutiny, actually after weeks of attack by this same organization, the Washington Post, New York Times, CNN, etc. But after weeks of that, Trump needed to restore some sense of legitimacy and strength to his flailing campaign. Yeah, I don't think it was flailing. But anyway, what better way to do this than to stand statesmanlike next to the president of Mexico? Trump, says the Washington Post, played the role to perfection. Subdued, even solemn, he owned the proceedings. Trump chose when and how he wanted to visit Mexico. He established the meeting's agenda. He laid out a five-point plan for a bilateral relationship and a potential Trump presidency. He even chose who got to ask the questions during the brief news conference that followed the usual statements because, you know, he's had a lot of practice doing this. He's had 16 press conferences. Hillary has had zero press conferences. And they go on to say, he deftly placed himself on equal footing with the president of Mexico. A master of optics, Trump used the setting to his advantage, calling Peña Nieto, I don't know how to pronounce his name, sorry folks, I'm not Spanish. A master of optics, he used the setting to his advantage. He called him a friend. He conveniently shook his hand for front page ready photos. He avoided anything resembling an apology, and albeit in more careful terms than before, he stood by the construction of a border barrier. Okay? Meanwhile, even NPR says Trump makes nice in Mexico. He struck his most presidential pose to date. And then you got The Hill pointing out that everybody was saying he can't come back from this deficit. You know, his former campaign manager, Manafort, said, you know, we were never planning to win in August. We're planning to win in November. And even William Kristol says, it's hard when you're a challenger to seem presidential. Trump standing there for all the awkwardness looks presidential. A good day for Trump. And Hillary's former communication director said, if you believe Trump needed to pivot, moderate, and look more presidential, the event was a home run. Join us tonight for the InfoWars Nightly News, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.